Hey, Music Relish Show, episode 37, with Mark, Lou, and Perry. I'm French now, so it's Mark, Lou, and Perry. How you doing?
Perry.
Mark, Louis, and Perry.
Oh, that's right, Louis. That's French.
That's French.
Sacre bleu.
So tonight we have, we're going to talk about Rockfield Studios. Mark tipped me off about this, so I'm interested to learn about Rockfield Studios in Wales, I believe.
Where's Wales?
England.
UK.
Where in England?
It is part of the UK.
Down southwest.
Southwest.
And we're going to have some random relish. We're going to have a little look at future rock stars and guess who they are. We're going to have a one-hit wonder from Lou. We're going to do some trivia. And we're going to talk about a few other things other than that. So,
a guitar player songwriter we're going to talk about.
Yeah, we are. Yep.
Yeah.
And we're going to get the papers.
Hello. That's me. That's, I'm Perry two times.
Perry two times.
So, Mark, Rockfield Studios. Do you want to talk about Rockfield Studios in Wales?
Sure. Hey, guys. Good to see you again.
Hey.
Good to see you, too.
Rockfield Studios. I call them the Sound City of England, because they've spanned generations and musical genres. So a little background on them.
Yeah.
Brothers Kingsley and Charles Ward grew up on a farm in the Wye Valley, just outside the village of Rockfield in Wales, England, that their parents bought in 1958. While their parents were hoping they would one day take over the farm, the brothers instead got the rock and roll itch, and they purchased a portable quarter-inch recorder and started recording in a front room of the family house on the farm. Making a demo, they made their way up to London and got an audience with George Martin, who was impressed with the portable recorder, but not really with the music. The Ward brothers returned to London the following year and met with Joe Meek at his studio.
I've heard that name too. Yeah. He's a famous producer, right?
Joe Meek.
Meek signed them, and the brothers recorded songs as the Charles Kingsley Creation and as the Thunderbolts while observing Meek's studio techniques. They were watching. Back home, the brothers set up a recording studio in an attic space with a Rosser electronics mixing console and a ferrograph tape machine. In 1961, the brothers began recording local bands in their studio, which they named Future Sounds Limited, charging £5 per acetate.
Wow.
Acetates.
So that's a demo. You're making a demo.
The original floppy disk.
Yeah, there you go. In 1963, the brothers converted an existing farmhouse on the property into a recording studio by investing in an 8-track tape deck, putting them on the same level as Abbey Road and other major studios.
Wow.
They deadened the room by hanging pig feed bags around the studio. I would have called it pig feed studios, but that's just me. In 1965...
That sounded more like a pub, didn't it?
Yeah, really? Yeah.
In 1965, American band Elephant's Memory came to record, but had nowhere to stay as Rockfield had no hotels at that time in town. So the brothers put them up in the family house with their parents. Rockfield at this point became the first residential studio in England in which artists could live on the same property as a studio and concentrate more on the recordings and not have to deal with the distractions of the big
city. And relax and driving back and forth, right?
Yeah. It was a nouveau, novel thing at the time.
It's kind of like an Airbnb with a recording studio in it.
Yeah. Kind of like Woodstock, right?
Yeah.
Between 1968 and 1969, the brothers took over the former horse barn and opened the coach house studio. Kingsley's goal, again, was to keep the studio on the same level as Abbey Road and other big studios in London, but with the rural countryside as a setting for artists to record. I Hear You Knocking was recorded by Dave Edmonds in this studio.
Are you kidding?
Very cool. Wow.
I love that friggin' song, man. I love his version of that song.
You know why? It's a classic rock. It's a single. It's just a single tune.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. And he had been recording there since 66 in various capacities. He was tight with the owners, with those brothers.
So. Oh, and by the way, Dave Edmonds plays all the instruments on that pretty much. I think he even played drums on it.
Huh. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. The drums just go. Shh, shh.
Yeah. Yep.
Good sound. Good sample.
Yeah.
Other things recorded, Silver Machine by Hawkwind, which is probably their most popular album, was recorded there.
And they're really not familiar with them.
With Lemmy on vocals.
Oh, yeah. I've heard that. I knew he was in the band Hawkwind. I heard one or two songs, but wow.
Hawkwind really loved Rockfield. If you see the documentary, because they did a lot of drugs and they just loved doing the drugs and wandering around the countryside. You know? Also in 69, Black Sabbath stayed for a spell. They recorded demos for Paranoid. There's a lot of people that think Paranoid was recorded there. It was just the demos for the album, but they loved the property. There's pictures of Ozzy Osbourne. He got a wooden skid and he's floating out in a river and he's going wild. And he said he had a rifle. He was going out and shooting and they had a lot of fun. Now, in 1973, expanding again, another studio was created on the grounds, the Quadrangle. It was created in the former pig shed, right? Movable walls enabled bands to get sounds of different types of room echo in one room. This method of movable walls was also used for recording the drums, so you could get a spacious sound or a tight sound. Nowadays, it sounds like a big deal. No one did that at the time. You went to a different studio.
On this property, on this farm.
Yeah.
There's three functioning recording studios in there?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, at this time, I think there's only two. I think that original studio may not be in use, but the Quadrangle and the Coach House, are still in use. The Quadrangle is the most used.
Wow.
So in the Quadrangle, Ace featuring Paul Carrack recorded the song How Long in 1974.
Cool. Wow.
Yeah.
Which is a great sounding record.
Oh, yep. That's great. Yep. That song never gets old. Yeah. Queen came to record their third album, Sheer Heart Attack, in 1974, and then returned in 1975 to record A Night at the Opera. Freddie Mercury could be heard playing the piano in a small room and finishing Bohemian Rhapsody, according to the owner. You could just hear him working on it. So all those vocal overdubs were done in the Quadrangle. Everything.
Well, see, I would have thought they were done in London at a big studio, right?
Yep. Me too, yeah.
And somehow Roy Thomas Baker was able to distort the drums there, too. It's amazing.
It's Marv Bloody Distortion.
Also, in 1975, Lemmy returned to Rockfield with his new band Motorhead and made their first recordings at the studio. They were briefly signed to Rockfield Studios record label, but then they got signed by, I believe, EMI, whatever. Now, move forward to 1977. Rush came to Rockfield and recorded Farewell to Kings.
That's right.
Now, if you know, like in the intro to the first song, Farewell to Kings, you hear Alex Lifeson's acoustic, that nice little quiet intro. If you listen on headphones, you hear the birds chirping. They recorded it in the courtyard outside the studio. And so you hear like the Rockfield, the whales, birds, whatever. But you know, it's a little off tempo because you hear Neil Peart trying to play the bells with it, and he's kind of like, it's a little off.
It's a little distracting. Mm-hmm. It's funny. I just listened to that last week. That's the Rush album I'm probably the least familiar with, except for some, you know, a few of those songs, you know. But
it was great kind album. Of a in between because after that, in 1978, they put out Hemispheres. That was also recorded at Rockfield.
Yeah,
I was
beginning of their modern period. Farewell to Kings is the last record of the old period.
Yeah, Roosh. I think Hemispheres really is because they did that sidelong epic and then that was it, you know. But I always remarked when I was young, seeing, wow, they recorded albums in Wales. That was just like weird because everything else was in Canada.
Yeah, in Toronto.
Yep.
At the Le Studio.
Oh, yeah. We should talk about that.
It's barren now. It's just vacant concrete, right?
Right.
It burned.
Oh, it did?
They had a fire? Yeah.
Wow.
So who else
they
is
busted
that?
The joint, they busted the joint out.
It's a damn drummer.
Next week.
So in the late 70s and early 80s, Rockfield recorded pivotal recordings in the burgeoning new wave scene. Simple Minds, who were recently signed, had recorded at Abbey Road, but were not comfortable there. They found it very stuffy. They were a new band. They felt kind of intimidated. They went to Rockfield and stayed for most of a year recording their first album. Singer Jim Kerr said, and I'm paraphrasing, that the studio is a bit rough, but gives the ability to be flexible in production from track to track, depending on the mood of the song being recorded. You can get the different room sounds. They recorded their first notable hit, Changeling, at the sessions, as well as Promised You a Miracle. Now, this is a kind of a funny story. At the same time Simple Minds were recording at Rockfield, Iggy Pop was in the other studio recording. He He was supposedly on the wagon. David Bowie showed up one night with beers, kind of knocked Iggy off the wagon, kind of turned into a wild scene. And when they were recording, they dragged the guys from Simple Minds into the studio to sing backing vocals. So there is an Iggy Pop album with them singing.
Cool. That must have been in like the former pig barn or something.
Yeah. The coach house. Yeah.
the pig drangle. the pork drangle.
The pork rib drangle. Mm-hmm. Another notable thing, two albums that are important to me, Robert Plant. He came to Rockfield to record his first two studio albums, Pictures at 11 and really? Principle of Moments. Wow. Now, having recently gone through the shock of Bonham's death and trying to find his way as a solo artist, the pastoral settings of Rockfield helped him find his voice. He attributes everything on those first albums finding his way to Rockfield.
Yeah. Wow.
And he says,
I was mistaken about those kind of things. I used to bitch like, oh, Genesis, those rich guys. They're always going to like an estate to record, like, Shropshire. You know, like. Yeah, like, all right, but, you know, this is a farm. It's more a little more humble, you know. It's not the Richard Branson estate.
You're not paying for it, you know.
Yeah.
It's a record company's putting you up until your record, you know, against your royalties or whatever.
That's right.
Yeah.
Have a good 12 months recording, because when your first album comes out, you're not getting a penny, right?
You're not going to drive home after every session. Or stay. I'd rather do that and stay at a hotel.
Yeah. Yeah. Or if you stay in the studio, that couldn't be better, you know?
Yep.
I mean, look at that setting.
Now, beautiful.
What's the difference between pastoral and bucolic? Isn't it almost the same thing?
I think they're just another definition for each other, right? Well,
a country-like setting, I think.
But would you consider your home, Lou, bucolic or pastoral?
I'm not sure. I would say pastoral because I'm more familiar with the term. Bucolic sounds like you can't poop.
Bucolic sounds like there's a bear in the neighborhood.
She's got the bucolic. We're not going to go anywhere for a while.
Look at that setting, though, man. Would you like to hang out there and work for a few weeks on a record, right?
It's about a 5-minute drive into town to the pub, which I'll talk about in a second because the pub saw a lot of crazy stuff.
Yeah.
Especially with Motorhead, I bet.
More so in the 80s and 90s. 80s. Yeah.
Got to have that pub.
Pub.
And the pub grub.
Well, anyway, in the mid 80s, though, they started to lose business because dance music was getting big with drum machines and engineers, artists didn't really care about ambience. So a lot of stuff was being done. And that's the beginning of the small studios that could produce a monster hit, you know. So they went through really, really hard times. And at this point, the brothers decided to split up to save the business. Charles moved up the road and set up a new studio called Mono Valley Studios. And I believe they don't say much about what was recorded there, but I think it did cater more to the dance music sound. Really? It kept they were booking bands in there. But also Oasis did record part of their first album at Mono Valley too. In 1989, Rockfield had a savior come in the form of the Stone Roses. Do you remember them?
Yeah.
Okay. They stayed for 13 months to record their debut album. And that 13 months kind of helped them, you know. Then they got signed by Geffen Records, which gave them a worldwide distribution, and they were a hit. But they returned to Rockfield to record their next album, Second Coming, which I love. And they took
picked up by David Geffen.
Well, they took 14 minutes to record it. And according to the documentary, at one point, Geffen executives said, we want to come out and see what's going on. It was like 12 months had passed. And they came out and the band didn't even show up. They were gone because what they were doing is somebody treated them wrong in London, and they went and covered their car with paint, and they showed up at the studio with paint all over them. There's pictures of it. But
somebody from the Geffen Corporation, you mean?
No, it's somebody else. But Geffen were getting pissed off. Pub. You know? I mean, imagine the studio tab. Of 14 months. Yeah. I mean, just think about it, you know.
In the pub.
Yeah.
The pub tab.
Yeah. So that kind of put them back on the map. There you go. That was probably the 70s, the 24 track. It could be
huge.
Actually, it could be now. I'll get to that too. So in the 90s, as the music trends changed back to real drummers, thank God.
Yes.
You know, Stone Roses put them on the map. So Oasis, as I said, after recording some of their debut album, Definitely Maybe, at Mono Valley, came to Rockfield to record What's the Story, Morning Glory, which had hits such as Wonderwall, Champagne Supernova, and what was the third single off that one?
Go Away.
Yeah, there you go.
I can't go away. But Mark, I did see a little documentary on Oasis, and they were recording there, and it was like a sliding barn door.
Yeah.
Liam,
in the movie, he says right off the bat, dropping many F-bombs. The documentary has to be rated R just because of Liam's interview, but he doesn't remember recording any of the album. He doesn't remember anything.
Really?
It's just, yeah.
Hey, Perry. I'm sorry.
Hey, what?
How'd you like to work with that board? You know?
I wanted to get that.
It's 24 faders and things you can put your hands on and be tactile. You can twiddle your own knobs with your fingers.
That's what Mark said. That when did they get the 24-track, 2-inch machine, Mark?
They had it in the 70s, but it came back. But see that picture you're showing now, Perry?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, just people listening, they're showing like an Ampex multi-track, and there's boards with bias settings. When I worked at CPI, I just had four of those, and I had to align. That drove me crazy. That's why you have a studio tech. Look at all those cards. You have to there. You have to put a tone in. But
you could do that at the end. I mean, you just record. You know what I mean. There's the record button. You know, this is right, Lou. I mean, we could handle this, right?
Yeah, of course.
But in a studio, you have to align it every day. You know, in a professional recording studio, you know, because God forbid.
That's a 24-track, 2-inch multi-recorder, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I like the fact that the channel operations are facing you. There's a wall that goes up behind it. It looks like you're opening up an old turntable. And that's all controls.
Machine.
The VU meters as well.
Give me some of my old days back. I had a 4-track Ampex from like the 60s. I just miss it. Anyway, it's hard to even get the tape anymore. Other artists, though, Rockfield in the 90s got huge. It was probably their most successful decade. The Charlatans recorded there. The Boo Radleys.
The Charlatans.
I love the Boo Radleys.
Yeah.
They recorded their album, Wake Up Boo.
I'm going to mention the Charlatans later on, too.
Okay, now, Lou, Charlatans, were they the ones the keyboardist died?
I don't know, but the drummer went on to be in a pretty cool band all of his own, but we can get to that.
Okay. So the Boo Radleys recorded Wake Up Boo. You know that album, Perry?
I have it.
Manic Street Preachers recorded Tolerate This, Your Children Will Be Next, and Generation Terrorists. Those are good albums.
Cool titles.
Yeah. Now, my one knock against the studio in the 90s is they were digital, as everybody was digital. And I always thought the Oasis album sounds very sterile, almost harsh. I'm not into the production of it. But it's what the 90s was.
I know how to make digital sound warm.
You feed it through a cassette player.
If you have to, yeah.
You make a mixtape.
You use Behringer preamps.
Yes, Behringer is very fine. Would you like to see mine, Perry?
Product placement.
And I am drinking Yellowtail. All right. Hear that, Castle Brothers? In 2000, Rockfield made a very risky move. They went all analog in the recording processes.
Yes.
And they got all vintage equipment, not even new equipment. It was seen as a huge risk because digital was still big. But the risk paid off because there were a growing number of bands that wanted to utilize the analog process again. Yep.
True believers.
Yeah. So they got back on the map for that. These guys reinvented themselves constantly. In the same year, Coldplay started recording their debut album, Parachutes, at Rockfield. And Chris Martin wrote the single Yellow while in the control room. And in the documentary, you got to hear him describe it. He was mimicking Neil Young. He's hilarious sounding. I didn't know they recorded there.
Big time.
That was probably, I think, the last big thing, but they're still active.
Now, you did tell me about a documentary that you saw.
Yeah.
About Rockfield Studios.
The one thing I like about Rockfield that impressed me.
Yeah.
Even though it's rough in many ways, it's found a way to transcend the genres and trends to keep at the top of the recording game. This guy Kingsley is still in charge, and he knows what to do. He still rides his tractor. By the way, when you record there, he goes out and takes care of the animals, and then he comes in, sees that everything's doing. He still feeds the cows.
Well, I've seen the poster. Cool. In the poster, you can see Robert Plant. It's kind of like a little Sergeant Pepper thing, you know?
You can see Ozzy.
Ozzy's there. You can see Robert Plant, right?
Yep.
Looks like Ozzy's on his pontoon boat.
You could see Queen on the in the back on the right. Yep.
I don't see Rush. Maybe they didn't give their permission.
Did you mention Lou Reed?
I see Geddy Lee there.
I see. Oh, yeah. Did you say Bob Plant?
Bobby Plant is there. Yeah, you can't miss him. There. Yeah. Where's Geddy Lee? Goddess, right? Or the golden god.
He's the only one in color. No, him and who? No, there's one, two, three. Four, there's five people that are in color that I can see.
He's in color.
He's in color. The rest are in black and white.
This documentary, by the way, it's available on Prime, but you have to have the Coda Collection, which is this add-on, which is a great little add-on on Prime. They have all
music.
I'm
going to watch it on Prime.
I highly advise it. It's inspiring to see a studio last so long. The brother, by the way, that split, he died in 2022, but Kingsley is still alive and well, and they're booking new bands, you know?
Cool.
I hope they have a plan to have someone take it over when he passes, because... that's a long run for a studio. Think about it.
Yeah. And, you know, also, you know, there's a nostalgia thing, too. You know, like digital is, it's not everybody's cup of tea, man. You know, there's still an analog world out there.
Yeah.
I think it's just what you do with it. Like, digital works fine. Like, I have Pat Metheny CDs. Digital sounds great. It sounds
well,
warm.
Well, like Lou said, you know, you can warm them up. You can warm them up, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
So anyway, what do you guys want to do?
Run through some Behringer preamps, and you'll get the sound you need.
And pour some wine from Yellowtail.
There's a hole living in your building.
There's Calicchio.
And if you really want, you can get some Gnarly Head Grateful Dead wine.
Very good.
Oh, no. Come on. This is like...
Remember the Wayne's World where they... Remember the Wayne's World scene where they all were like wearing Nikes and one scene where...
Well, how about we do some random relish? Anybody have some stray subjects? I've got
random
one.
Relish.
I've got random mustard. Mustard relish.
Don't drop it on your shirt, Perry.
Well, Mark, a couple of weeks ago, you had mentioned about Jerry Garcia.
Shit. Uncle
you
Jerry.
Had said that it's called GFP. It's the Garcia Family Provisions.
Yeah.
And I believe... that they protect his image, like the image of Jerry Garcia for T-shirts or whatever products is owned by Jerry Garcia, which I think is a great thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's like not Che Guevara where you can just print and, right?
They work synonymously with Grateful Dead. So if you want to buy a Jerry Garcia solo album or Jerry Garcia band album, it's coming from Garcia Family Provisions. They market all, you could buy shirts, you could buy cooler beer cooler thing, anything. It's his daughter, I believe, runs it.
You got salami and other cured meats.
Yeah,
maybe.
Yeah,
it says provisions. I expect like pickles, condiments.
It's the best.
Yeah, but I believe that the image of, you know, Marilyn Monroe, someone owns that image.
Yeah,
right. We had a little conversation many months ago about like Peter Frampton and these people, right? They were like saying, no, this is.
Yeah. Well, as a musician, as a music lover, they're beating the bootleggers just like the Dead are doing. They're releasing every month. They put out one of Jerry's concerts that was widely bootlegged, and they put them out direct from the board recording. So it's another good thing. They're protecting him, but they're also giving the fans good stuff, you know?
Yeah. What were you saying, Lou?
Do you remember Jerry Garcia neckties in the 90s? Early 2000s.
I do remember. I've never seen one, but I do. No, I actually saw one. Yeah. I used to work with somebody who had one.
I think so. Yeah.
Yep.
You know, it was some of his artwork put on a necktie. They weren't bad. I mean, it's kind of weird that, you know, such a countercultural icon would have his artwork on something that's so part of the, you know, the man, you know.
Correct.
The suit.
Right. Yeah. It's it's the duality of man, sir.
It's the Jungian thing, man.
I think he saw Bob Weir wearing the Latigre shirts, and he said, "I got to do something," you know.
Yes, yeah. Bob went polo shirt. He went polo.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. It was the 80s. It was the 80s. They're making money, you know. Everybody was having
shirt,
it all
with the collars and no buttons.
Flip up.
Yep.
Yeah.
Flipped up. And it's funny, Bobby was never really hippie. Even in the 70s, he was wearing those lapel suits. But
that's so Marin County.
But now he's hippie.
I hear wind chimes.
He's got the beard and everything, you know?
Oh, yeah. So,
yeah.
I like Bob Weir's. So I like Kingfish. I like it.
Oh, it's good stuff, yeah.
I like that band Rat Boy.
Rat Box.
Rat Dog.
Rat Dog.
Rat Dog.
I know.
Bat Masterson.
Somebody called my dog a rat dog one
time. Ooh. No. Buddy?
No. Yeah, it was Buddy.
Oh, man. Buddy's a rat dog. Buddy was great.
I'll tell you later. Anyway, side note. So that was very interesting. All those acts, and like you said, you know, they managed to like ride some changes out.
What were you saying, Mark?
So many studios, including Bearsville. I mean, I don't believe Bearsville's even operating anymore. Like, these are legendary studios.
They're not up. They're not.
I think they might have. I could be wrong.
About a 30-year lifespan, apparently, or about that.
Wow.
So if you were founded in 63 and it's now 2023, how many years is that? That's a lot of years.
60.
We all know that Gold Star Studios, right?
Yeah.
Remember Gold Star? It lasted 33 and a third years. That's how long Gold Star was in existence.
Wow.
Where was that? In California?
Yeah, L.A. Santa Monica. Yeah. I don't know where it was. Hollywood and Vine.
No,
Heart Attack and Vine.
On both of mine and Perry's Behringer effects units, we have, it's called Gold Plate. It's actually a recreation of the famous Gold Star reverb.
The Behringer virtualizer.
that's what it's called.
I can look at my Behringer from here, guys. It's very nice. It's a wonderful unit.
Do you know, remember EMI Studios?
Yeah.
Did you know it was an acronym, EMI?
Electromagnetic imaging.
That's a good guess, though.
That was good.
Want to guess at the what EMI actually stands for?
European Masters Industries. I don't know.
It actually means Epstein. Electric Musical Instruments.
That's lame. That's
stupid.
Well, that's the business they were in, I guess, before they owned. You know, I mean, EMI was involved in the beginning of television. They're an electronics company.
That is the business they've chosen.
Next week.
Our Shea, that's right.
But George Martin once told Jimmy Webb that George Martin actually, you know, admitted to Jimmy Webb that Sergeant Pepper was an attempt to sound like Pet Sounds. He outright admitted it. Yeah.
And cool. Just like he was, they kind of like were feeding off the birds with one of their albums too, you know? They kept with what was big.
Yeah.
Influenced by it. By the way, the last time I'll say this tonight, you know what Behringer stands for? Really great equipment. That's just like, all right, I'm done.
I don't have that, but I'm...
Was that a random? Is that a random relish?
That's all random. We're still random, yeah.
Okay. I got one.
Random and ranting,
I found out through my company's email, the Mighty Metro Wines on 169 Charlotte Street in beautiful Asheville, Jesus. North Carolina.
OMG.
Anyway, so in our email, I found that Jimi Hendrix was a wine lover, but he liked a certain type of wine. I want you guys to guess. I'm doing a lot of multiple choice tonight.
What type of wine did he want? Did he like?
Yeah. He favored a certain style.
Liebfermilch. German.
I'm going to ask you the question. Was it A, white wine, B, red wine, C, rosé wine, or 4, sparkling wine? White, red, rosé, or chen, or bubbles. Bubbles.
Jimi Hendrix liked rosé.
That's Perry's answer. Mark, what do you say?
I'm going to be hopeful because my idol, Keith Emerson, was a white wine guy. So I think it goes with creativity. I'll say white wine, please.
The answer was rosé. Perry, you are correct.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah, man.
He liked a certain type of rosé. He was a producer that was very... That's enough of that. Okay, so he liked a certain producer that was popular in the late 60s. Now, it's an A or B question. Was it A, Matus, or B, Lancers? Mark, you go first.
I'm going to go with Lancers.
I'm going with the Portuguese.
They're both Portuguese, I believe.
Oh, Matus. Matus.
Perry gets the double. It was Matus. Very good.
And Perry knew all that. He knows all this because he reads up on Jimi Hendrix. Right?
I've actually tried both.
I found it out through our company email, which comes out every Sunday. And also, I think Matus became something else. I think I forgot there was a tie-in to a current Portuguese vineyard that still, maybe still has the land holdings or something.
Ripple.
I should all clarify vineyard, that.
Wasn't it?
It ain't a Ripple. I'm not in Portugal. That's America. We do that here. That's what we feed our people.
Not to turn this into a wine show, but I've never liked rosé, but somebody at the hospital just told me recently, if you don't like rosé, it's because you've never had a good rosé. So I'm got to hunt for a good rosé. I probably have had like the cheaper stuff, you know.
I can recommend one for you because I think I know what you like. Find yourself an Austrian Zweigelt. Z-W-E-I-G-E-L-T. Zweigelt Rosé. Middelbach, preferably. Remarkable.
Z-W-E-I.
The Music Relish Show wine segment.
Wait, spell that again?
It's random. It's random.
That's random.
Logical randomness. What's that?
Z-W-E-I.
E-I-G-E-L-T. Zweigelt.
Okay.
And Gelt meaning like Yiddish for money. Like guilt.
Okay.
Now, have you...
Thank you.
Have you heard the new Beatles song?
No.
No, I won't. I'm not ready.
Okay. I know Scott McLean, our friend in Florida from Milk Crates and Turntables, has heard it. I've heard it. I heard it today.
Perry, and was this a song that somebody just created on their own? It didn't come from Apple?
No, it's an actual tape of John Lennon, a cassette tape that Yoko had given to Paul.
Oh, okay.
And he had the tape, and he actually wrote on it for Paul.
Okay. So, wow. And Giles Martin put this together?
I don't know. I think Jeff Lynne. I think Jeff Lynne and Paul... Ringo.
That makes sense.
But
I can imagine Jeff Lynne working with Paul.
Well, it goes a little bit into AI. Because
what is it? What does AI mean? I don't like
acronyms. Artificial intelligence.
Like our friend Perry. AI.
Obsessed intestines.
But Sean Penn had sent out some messages via, social media that the only AI they used was to clean up the noise on the noisy cassette that he recorded on a boombox or a cheap tape recorder. And it's the same AI technology that they used for Peter Jackson, that Peter Jackson used in that Beatle documentary. Oh. The 8-part, whatever it was, Get Back.
Get Back.
It was the same AI. So really the AI, it's not a generated voice of John Lennon.
Really?
It's actually John Lennon singing. The artificial intelligence was used to let it know that he's singing. He's not singing. He's singing. He's not, just to clear, because there was a lot of noise on the tape.
Yeah. All right. Then I get it. I'm so okay with that.
Could they go back and redo Free as a Bird? And some
with
of the
technology
others,
they the have now, they probably could and re-release it. Yeah, that's a good point. They probably could.
They weren't bad.
They
weren't
did
bad
not have
sounding.
It in the 90s or whenever that came out. The
most likely 90s, yeah.
Yeah. They did not have the AI technology that they have now back then. But speaking of AI, I know a lot. There's good AI and there's bad AI. And to me, the good AI is sort of like Val Kilmer being able to speak. That's a use of artificial that's really helpful and good.
Roger Ebert and other people.
Right. The bad AI to me is these deep fakes and and also I know people that work in schools. And this is a story I've heard is that I won't say where or anything like that, but the book reports, you get D's, you get F's, then you get an A. The kid admitted that he used artificial intelligence to write the report for him. So all you do is you put the query out there, and AI will generate the report for you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's a bad use of AI, in my opinion, because
truly
you're
scary.
Not,
you're learning nothing.
You're dumbing yourself down.
Yeah.
About 6 months ago, there was a reporter from the New York Times wrote an article. He spent about a month talking to an AI bot, and the answers to his questions, it was actually starting to try to have an affair with him. He was like saying, the AI said, "Are you married?" And he said, "Yes." "Are you happy?" "Yes, I am." The AI was like, "I don't think you're happy. I think you need to be with me." Like, it's definitely weird. And if you get some lonely guy that sits in a room, and or someone, telling him to kill somebody, that's what scares me.
Yeah. Wow.
Well, what I don't like is AI has no emotion. Although they try and add inflection to it now, but you know, when you write a song, you're writing a song with heart and emotion. Humans only have that. AI does not have that. Mm-hmm. They cannot program emotion into a, you know, even if it's data from Star Trek.
Well, you think at some point maybe they can, what they can do is find some way to sample, like taking an emotive singer, like James Brown or something. And find a way to graft, I don't know, if you can distill some type of sound out of that, something to actually graft, you know, because he's soulless.
Right.
Make him sound real, make him sound like people are doing it.
Well, they're trying to defeat that because, you know, now, I can always tell when it's AI, but like you know, Mark used to joke that it was, hello, how are you? You know, now they actually add inflection, you know, the AI searches for it.
Yeah,
but it's still AI. It's AI.
Customer service inflection. You know, hi, how can I help you?
Yeah, but there's, and if like you say, if you tell me to go scratch,
they're like, there's no need to talk like that.
Right.
We know
good AI is cleaning up an old noisy cassette.
We're only only trying to help you. We're trying to help you.
Lou, your camera's kind of jittery.
Well, AI.
I prefer to be called artificial human.
I was against it when it first came out, but I've accepted, like, I hear the pros. It's just, it's got to be watched. It's got to be controlled. It really does. Because what was that Arnold Schwarzenegger movie where the machines took over the world? I mean, it's almost like we're getting to that point.
Total Predator.
You know?
The T-800? The T-800?
Yeah. Terminator. Yeah, but not that. But, you know, it's just like these computers really are getting to be what was science fiction when we were growing up.
Also, the Avengers, Ultron. Artificial intelligent being that tried to wipe out humanity.
I saw that. Yeah.
Because, you know, if something can, you know, get into defense systems, or they can find a way to think enough to bypass, you know, vocal commands, that they can actually recreate a human voice. We're effed. Yep.
Well, we need to go back to Isaac Asimov's Rules for Robots. Remember that? The iRobot. He had Isaac Asimov had 10 rules for robots or something, and they were all very good.
Interesting.
That's our geek segment of the show.
Well, I'd like to stomp on those little robots that vacuum your floor. I don't know. I'd like to stomp on those friggin' things.
Yeah, that's gonna trip someone like Talking Tina from the that Twilight Zone episode. It's gonna trip you up and kill you one day. It's gonna be an AI murderous assassinating vacuum cleaner. That's how they're gonna get us. Like, that's how they're gonna get all of us that way.
Hi, fucker. I'm here.
Or even
rub your ass into hell.
Like that Chevy Chase movie, Deal of the Century, you know, where he was an arms dealer. And they had this drone. It was out of control, going wherever it wants, you know, and like shooting things.
There is a movie on Netflix about a doll that's created by a company that has AI. It's a really good movie. It's kind of funny, but it ends up killing people. But it's I forget the name of it. But
yeah, as long as it's funny, so, when it's killing people.
Yeah,
we'll swing it back around though. There was good AI and bad AI. Yeah, the good AI is Val Kilmer being able to speak.
Yeah,
and you know, things like that. And I guess even back at Stephen Hawking, I don't know if that was AI, but maybe it was an early version of AI or whatever, right?
However that was done, yeah.
But good AI that using, you know, but you know, Scott McLean had done a news story about how I think what the Noel Gallagher had said, the AI is going to ruin the music business, and it's here already, and that's what it is. So I had suggested to Scott that Millie Vanilli should get their Grammys back, because this is nothing compared to what's going on now. So their Grammys should be reinstated.
Well, somebody texted me. Was it you, Perry? Somebody texted me that the Grammys will not accept any music for consideration written by AI.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's here.
Excluded.
Until when?
Yeah, right.
Until the bots take over.
Until
Dave. who had the computer Dave? 2001 Space Odyssey. Stanley Kubrick.
That was Hal. Wasn't Hal. It was David Bowman. I think it was
oh, no, I saw Hal. Another one where the computer was Dave. Yeah, I think Kevin Spacey was in that movie.
Oh, yeah. Well, the movie I was referring to is called Megan on Netflix, and it's a freaky movie. You should see it.
Maybe I'll check it out.
Be altered slightly, because you'll hit some scenes you're like, should I laugh?
Be altered slightly.
Just my advice.
Can we leave this dystopian landscape behind and move on to some lighter fare?
Yeah. Well, why don't we do some future rock stars?
Future rock stars.
Future rock stars.
I mean, like, so what I do is people that will one day become rock and roll stars, or like rock stars of the future, like space age
rock. Rock stars of the future. Yeah.
Oh my God. Who cares?
Who the hell cares? So what we'll do I have about 10 pictures of future rock stars when they were youngsters. So what I'll do is I'll ask Mark and Lou to doff their headphones for a minute, and I will say to anyone listening out there, in order of the five pictures I'm going to show, and let's see if our so-called musical experts guess.
I'm not going to take my headphones off and turning my volume down. I won't hear you. Okay.
All right. Do what you do, Lou. Yeah, okay. You want to doff your headphones?
I'm going to doff my headphones, and then when you're ready, I'm going to don them.
Don them. Okay.
Doff and don, boys.
I will cue you. Okay. In order, I'm going to show a picture of Keith Richards, Prince, Steve Lukather, Ian Anderson, and Bruce Dickinson. In that order. Keith, Prince, Steve Lukather, Ian Anderson, Bruce Dickinson. Let's see if they can guess it. Okay.
Okay, I'm back.
Come back, Lou.
My headphones are donned.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Donned your headphones.
Did you put your protective gear on, Lou?
It's a donned headphone.
Okay, so I'm going to show a picture of a youngster, and you have to see.
That sounds weird.
Some people out there already know who it is, but this is a picture of a young future rock star. Wow, what am I missing?
I got to take a peek. I'm laughing too hard.
You're going to show a picture of a youngster. I said, that's kind of weird. Not everyone has a camera. This is a podcast, right?
Yes. Right. This is a clean show.
Not so anymore.
I'm going to show a picture of a young boy playing.
Okay. It's a clean fucking show.
Oh, God.
Here it goes. Who is this future rock star, people?
Well, we just lost Behringer. The Minnow.
Can you guess this future rock star?
Gilligan.
I can take a guess. I say Keith Richards.
Lou says Keith Richards.
I'm going with that, too. Those ears are Mr. fucking Smith? Ugly. I'm going with Keith Richards as well.
That is Keith.
Keith.
Keith Richards. Yeah.
Keith. The ears.
Wow.
Yeah. He's known as Keith.
So that was in 1496, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know when that was.
He was on his way back from Galileo's house, yeah.
Okay, here we go. Number two.
We keep our headphones on.
Yeah, I already did five of them in a row with the people listening out there. Yeah, yeah. Who is this future rock star? Can you guess this future rock star?
Prince.
Lou?
I'm going to say Prince. I agree with Mark.
That is Prince Rogers Nelson.
Prince Rogers Nelson.
Yep. That face. His first album, he doesn't look much different than that.
Okay, guys, that was two. How can you guess this future rock star?
Who plays guitar?
Future rock star.
I think I'm gonna take a shot at it. Steve Lukather?
I was just gonna say the same thing. I know those eyebrows anywhere.
Hey guys, it's Steve Lukather.
That is young Steve Lukather, teenage Steve Lukather. Yep.
Three for three, Mark.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow.
I know Luke anywhere.
You guys are kicking my ass, man.
But Lou, you got it before me.
It was the hair.
Yeah.
Okay, let me get my list here. Okay, here we go. Future rock star.
Oh, the old pictures.
He's wearing tartan plaid, that's for one thing. Is he a famous bagpiper?
That may help. We have a piper down.
Rod Stewart.
Bon Scott.
Okay. You're both wrong.
Oh,
that is Ian Anderson.
Oh,
never would guess that. That was he's Scottish.
He's Scottish descent.
I thought he was medieval.
He's a Scotsman. Yeah,
he's from Northern England.
He's in Scotsman regalia, yeah. But that's yeah. Ian Anderson.
He's very from cool. North England, but his mother is from Scotland, I believe. Okay. And he lives and he in Scotland now.
He was just glad okay. to be there.
I have one more in this segment, and then we'll doff our headphones
he's
again.
He's glad to okay. be alive.
Okay, so he's who is this over. Future? Who is this future rock star? Here we go.
This could be anybody.
Anthony Kiedis.
Anthony Kiedis? Mr. Lou?
Wow. John Mellencamp.
Mark is going to be disappointed. It's Bruce Dickinson.
Wow.
No one argues with him.
That's Bruce Dickinson. I guess so. Lead singer of Iron Maiden.
Yeah.
Bruce Air Raid Siren
and
Dickinson.
Producer of Don't Fear the Reaper by Lewis Tickle, according to SNL.
Okay.
Good one.
I have five more. I have five more. So Lou, do you wanna doff your headphones and Mark silence yourself?
I'll doff them.
I'm silenced.
Okay. There's the last five group in this order. Frampton, Michael Jackson, Tom Waits, Dave Gilmour, Rob Halford. Frampton, Michael Jackson, Tom Waits, Dave Gilmour, Rob Halford. Okay.
Okay, I'm back.
Okay.
It's great to be back. Great to
We're
be.
Back.
Good to be back.
Headphones
it's
have
great
been
great to
dying.
Be back. Tony Orlando, it's great to be back.
It's great to be back, man. Sammy Maudlin.
Okay, here we go. Can you guys guess, name this future rock star?
Cool guitar. Wish I could see it closer. A sandy-haired youth. He's showing good form, actually. Looks like he's been playing for a while, doesn't it?
It does. Looks like he's playing some leads, yeah.
Some 20-flight rock. I'm going to say Eddie Cochran.
He's an Englishman.
Eddie Cochran died in England. That won't count.
It's not the same.
Guys, I'm drawing a major, major brain fart.
It could be.
All right, so he looks like he's playing jazzy chords to me.
Peter Frampton.
It's Frampton. It's young Frampton.
Is it? Wow. Wow.
Yeah.
I was going to guess Mick Ralphs. I don't know.
You said jazzy.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I gave it away there, right?
Oh,
right, I've got another one. Can you guess
worry.
This?
Don't degrade my deductive capabilities. You're devaluing me.
Devalued like a Canadian dollar.
I tell you, Kidley, that's a good form right there. Go Peter.
I probably, what is he? Not even 10, probably.
He's playing at least 7.
No, he's playing.
Does he have his voice box in the barn? Mike, we do.
Was he a child prodigy?
Can you guess this future rock star?
Sam Cooke.
I can't even guess. I see no features.
You don't see Michael Jackson in there?
Michael Jackson?
You don't see Michael Jackson?
Not when he was with the Jacksons.
Well,
he didn't look
not
like
how
that
you remember him.
Yeah. Wow.
I forget.
I mean, okay, I'm just thinking of the ABC video. Wow.
Okay. That's Michael Jackson. That's young Michael Jackson.
Cool.
Okay. Trying to locate the next one here. Okay. Here we go. Can you guess this future star? Look at that kid. That's a Norman Rockwell. Look at that kid. I think I have one when he was a teen.
Johnny Cougar. Oh, James Hetfield.
He's American.
James Hetfield.
Oh, that's right. James Hetfield.
Same Ted headphone.
Can I see the other one? Can we do it back and forth?
Yeah, you want to see the younger one again?
Yep. Yes.
Hang on. I'll get back there. Here we go. There he is, the All-American kid.
All-American kid.
That's give David me fuel, Johansson. Give me fire.
No idea.
That's Tom Waits.
Oh.
That's Tom Waits right there.
And I guess yeah, James yep. Hetfield. Holy shit. James
Hetfield.
It looks like him.
And yeah, that's yeah, Tom. It does.
Whoa, what an American kid that guy is, yeah. right? Wow.
And when he talked,
that's not his real voice.
Okay, I've got two more. Here we go. Let me locate him here. Here it goes. Can you name this future rock star?
Very pompous British look.
Really? Oh, punk ass man. David Gilmour.
David Bowie.
It is David Gilmour.
Ah.
Yep.
Not quite a punk at all.
No, very preppy.
David Gilmour. David Gilmour.
Yeah.
They all went to prep, didn't they? Like Genesis, yeah. like the Charter House.
Not Phil.
Okay, let me see if I can locate the last one. Can you guys name this future rock star?
Phil Collins.
I was thinking that.
I'm going with Phil.
Phil Collins. I'm going to say Andy Partridge.
Those are fantastic guesses. But Mark, once again, it's Rob Halford.
Wow.
It is.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
He's yes, got another thing coming.
Wow. Yeah. Isn't that amazing?
Damn. Yeah.
Once you hear it, like, yeah, that is him. Yeah.
Doesn't he look miserable in that picture? Like he's either scared.
No, not at all. He's enjoying school, learning.
No, that's a setup picture.
It looks like he's signing a bill into law as a child.
Yeah. He's a House of Commons.
Birmingham.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Birmingham boy. Good ones, Perry.
Yeah,
I think future rock stars. What we have next is a one-hit wonder.
Yeah,
from Lou.
Lou, it is a one-hit wonder. We haven't done in a while. I haven't mentioned one in a while.
We haven't done a one-hit wonder in a while, have we?
No, we haven't. As usual, I always hear these things in the car driving to and fro. So yeah. I heard this on.
Sirius.
It was on the Underground Garage,
which is
Little Steven show. Little, Steven's
Little Steven, yeah, on Underground Sirius Garage, XM,
yep, channel 21.
I've heard the show. He's got a cool show. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yes, he
does. Heard a couple of clips of it. I don't have Sirius XM, but I have heard a couple of clips.
Oh yeah. You know, there's some regular DJs in rotation, of course, but you know, you hear some really cool stuff across different genres. So anyway, so I heard a song. It was called Hello, Hello. I'm like. Kind of had a sort of, you know, you can peg it toward the mid to later 60s, that kind of vaudeville jug bandy type of song that was kind of not really familiar at that time. I wouldn't call it mainstream music. But anyway, so the song was called Hello, Hello. And I remember I had heard the song quite a few times before. The chorus caught me. The band was called Sopwith Camel. And
After an airplane.
Because those fuckers are Messerschmitts. So they were San Francisco.
Camel was like a World War One,
triplane
or a biplane. Yeah.
Did Red Baron or Snoopy fly the Sopwith Camel?
Think the Sopwith Camel was. I think it was British. The Sopwith Camel.
I think it was a British plane. Snoopy flew in the War Party.
Snoopy versus the Red Baron. I had that 45.
Okay. Good for you. I have
Snoopy had a good imagination.
What about Sop? The band is called Sopwith Camel.
Sopwith Camel. So they were a psychedelic rock band from San Francisco. They formed in 1965. The members were Peter Kramer, vocals and sax, Terry McNeil, guitar, William Truckaway Stevens on guitar, Martin Beard on drums, and a guy named Norman Mayell on drums, who became their kind of archivist years later. Yeah. So they recorded one. They have an eponymous album that they recorded in the 60s. Their only one called Sop with Camel. They have some distinctions that they were the second San Francisco band that was signed to a national label. I don't know if the Airplane were the first or the Dead, or might not have been either. Could have been Quicksilver Messenger Service. Who knows?
Yeah, but they Dobie Gray, right?
Right. But they were the second San Francisco band signed to a national label. They were the first of all those bands to have a top 40 hit. So before the Grateful Dead, before the Airplane, Quicksilver, Moby Grape, well, they were never big hit bands.
Is the
anyway.
Song that we're about to do a sample of the song you're talking about?
It is the song. It's called Hello, Hello. Do you want to give it a spin?
I have a couple of samples of it. Let's do the part one.
And see, okay. Hey, Daddy-O, spin that record. Hello,
let's see. Hello. Drop that needle, Daddy-O.
I like your smile. Hello, hello. Shall we talk a while?
I don't remember ever hearing this on the radio.
Really? I did.
Would you like some of my tangerine?
Tangerines,
is that what he
must
said?
Been, yeah, tangerines must have been big in the
what
late
does that
60s.
Mean? Acid?
Well, it could be a drop, you know. I believe it's mentioned in there. Yeah, so that was, believe it or not, that was a number 26 on the Billboard Hot 100.
You're kidding. 1967?
Yeah. Now, when you hear it.
I can't remember it.
I do. It blends in. Well, it could be. Now, the first time I heard it, I said, this kind of sounds like the Love and Spoonful. It's got that same kind of feel.
It does. It has almost like that slightly novelty sort of.
It's almost vaudeville, that kind of vaudeville sound, which was not uncommon back then. You remember, I heard Alley Cat recently and Winchester Cathedral.
Yeah.
Not unsimilar. Maybe not as novel, but I mean, that could have been Donovan.
Vaudeville is
well.
A good description because you can see like a little show going on behind that.
Oh, yeah. Right? It's a shuffle of sorts. But it's really sung nicely. The lyrics are they're whimsical. When I heard this, I really enjoyed the whole thing. It has a very summery sound to me. But it's funny because they were produced by the same guy that produced the Love and Spoonful, a guy named Eric Jacobson. And just to give you a little side note, because Mark, you mentioned the Charlatans earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Eric Jacobson produced Tim Hardin, the Love and Spoonful, of course. Norman Greenbaum, I believe he produced Spirit in the Sky.
Wow.
Chris Isaac, and also Mark mentioned the Charlatans. So we mentioned the Charlatans never had a hit, but they were one of the first. They were helping invent that San Francisco sound. But the drummer was a guy named Dan Hicks. Do you know what he went on to do?
Dan Hicks and his Hot Licks.
That's right. Yeah.
Yep.
So that was a little bit of a random Relish side note, but you know, there's a million of them in anything we talk about.
Yeah. Would you like to hear another sample of,
Let's see. Hang on a second.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So that song was, number 26. They had a follow-up single called Postcard from Jamaica that cracked the top 100 from that same album, but it hit 88. So
it
they are a one hit wonder.
Yeah.
Did not
it didn't
hit the
top 40. Yep.
Right. So they went defunct in late 67. The two members, Martin Beard, the bass player, and Norman Mayo, the drummer, played with Norman Greenbaum. So they might be on Spirit in the Sky. And I think the drummer also went on to play with Blue Cheer.
Oh,
so yeah. Okay.
Spirit in the Sky, that hit was everywhere, man.
Yeah.
I mean, that thing, that's, I heard it all the time on the radio, all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
And even bought the 45. I didn't buy it, but we had it.
Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know who, if Eric Jacobson produced that, he did not like that guitar sound in Spirit in the Sky. And it's iconic.
I think it is. Absolutely.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
It defines the song. So if that's the case, a little subcategory is musicians who have played on like one hit wonders.
Yeah.
You know, so if that's the same drummer, he's played on two.
Write
two one
that
hit
down,
wonders.
Man. You got the notebook.
I remember. Yeah, sure. I will.
All right, you want to hear another sample of Hello, yes. Hello by Sop with Camel?
Yes, and then I have a little
let's
bit
see,
more.
Let's
little,
see if we
more...
get shut down.
Hello, let's do it.
You got pretty hair.
You got pretty hair.
Hello, hello.
There's the doubling thing,
can't
yeah.
Can't you tell I care?
The row, row, row your boat.
Would you like some of my tangerine?
Tangerine.
Interesting. I cannot remember ever hearing that on the radio once, and I listen to a lot of radio.
Sure you have, yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
But, yeah, so somehow I did, or whatever station, but so very cool. But, you know, but it wasn't all that, in that genre, it wasn't all that undistinctive from other bands that were doing the same
thing. You're right. That could have been the Love and Spoonful playing that, and or with Donovan. John Sebastian singing it, yep.
Yeah, yep.
Yeah,
good point. Perry. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I was say, Perry, when we were at the laundromat, what was your favorite guy on Underground Garage? Do you remember?
I don't.
Handsome Dick Manitoba.
Yeah.
That was a great show. I'd walk in, you'd be like, Mark, Handsome Dick Manitoba.
Well, he was
on.
Singer of a punk band, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Wild Kingdom. That was his band.
Yeah?
Yep.
Yeah, so that's a category of a song where... Yeah, it's almost like jug band almost. You know, it's got a little bit of all of that in there.
There could have been on a bill with Mungo Jerry.
Yeah. Well, Mungo Jerry was 1970.
Yeah. Well,
a couple years later.
But that's funny because this band, when I started listening to them, because, you know, they have two albums, basically.
Yeah.
I didn't listen to the eponymous one called Sop with Camel, but what they did is they reformed in 1971 with all of the members except for the bass player. Martin Beard was not there. Everyone else did. They recorded a second album called The Miraculous Hump Returns from the Moon, released in 1973.
I love that.
I listened to it today. It's really good.
Yeah.
So it's elements. It's almost like at times it's like vaudeville. It's like there's psychedelia, there's folk, there's rock, almost like some of that kind of stuff. Remember, you know, Rodriguez, Sugarman, some of that. It's jazzy and marked because, you know, Perry, I know you're not a big jazz fusion fan, but parts of it sound almost like Weather Report. I was surprised.
Wow. Really?
Good musicians, but pretty interesting. So it was described as pleasant hippie groove music, and I totally agree. Pleasant hippie groove music for a lazy summer afternoon. And so today was a lazy summer afternoon, and it was perfect. I really enjoyed it. The guy sung really well.
Yeah.
It's interesting. It's good to call it background music, but some of the categories this band has been kind of used to describe them is FM schmaltz, prog rock, jazz, show tunes, kraut rock, Indian classical, that kind of stuff. So, yeah, it was pretty diverse.
That's a wide-ranging thing as genres.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So they broke up for good technically in 1974. So 30 years later, the original... A copy of it was in Warner Brothers vaults, so they reissued it in CD in 2001 by the drummer Norman Mail. He had it reissued, and then in the second CD was issued in 2006. It was called Remastered. So what they did, they found the original master in Eric Jacobson, the producer's basement. He had the original master of this. So I think the record company would have it. Anyway, so they remastered that, and that's what I listened to today. And it sounds really good.
I'm sure they digitized it and whatever.
We know something. It's warm. Yeah. It's analog, but they probably cleaned it up. But it sounds like it was recorded with microphones and, you know, the whole booth and people smoking in the studio and all that.
So you said
stuff.
They were one of the first bands to be signed. Like, do you know what label they were signed to?
I think it was Warner Brothers.
Really?
I think it was the WB. Wow. Yeah, because their second. Well, you know, that's a good question because I don't know offhand because I think maybe they re-signed. When they reformed in 71, they might have signed with Warner Brothers. But good question. But no, they were on Kama Sutra. They were on Kama Sutra.
Kama Sutra. Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Now, who owned Kama Sutra?
The Mafia? No, that was roulette.
More sleep.
Kama Sutra had a lot of the bubblegum. Bubblegum.
I think the owner of Kama Sutra is referenced in this book.
Wasn't Neil Bogart? Neil Bogart.
He was Buddha, wasn't he? Buddha Records? I don't know.
Yeah. I get him. So, you know what? We're going to redo the book. We're going to do the Great American Bubblegum Show, right?
Didn't we do it already?
We did that on the radio. Yeah, we did that on the, on the cell phones.
Yeah, maybe, I thought we redid it for the cameras.
We did.
I don't think so.
Yeah, we did. We did a Bubblegum Show.
We did?
Do it again.
By the way, you may know these names. Kama Sutra was started by Arthur Artie Rip.
Yeah.
High Mitzrahi and Phil Steinberg. Do you know any of those names? You guys are walking encyclopedias.
But I'm sure in certain circles they are important names, right?
Who was the first guy, Mark?
Arthur Artie Rip.
No, Arthur Rip. I don't recall any of them.
Cy Benson. What's the matter, Lou? You can't talk up like a person, like a regular, normal human being.
Up your hole with a melon roll, Perry.
Did you know that Menudo were on Kama Sutra and Charlie Daniels Band?
They still what? Exist.
Wait, yeah, Kama but maybe Sutra for is a short time. You know, a lot of these acts, you see, they were on MCA. They were on Kama Sutra. They were on Warner Brothers. They
it just
were
shows that Kama Sutra was not just the 60s and early 70s.
I thought they might have folded.
Yeah.
I thought they might have folded under intense FBI
Well, they were
scrutiny.
Absorbed. Sometimes they get absorbed and they keep the name, though, you know, even though MCA buys them or whatever, right?
Yeah. And then they funnel money.
Yeah,
for it.
The original label ceased in mid 76, but restarted in 1981 as Sutra Records under the moniker. Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, it was restarted. Okay.
With paper bag money.
Yeah. There you go.
You know what I'm talking about?
We'll be talking about the next week. We'll be talking about the mafia, right?
This is anyway, movies, mob movies.
Not
actually
mob and the music.
Next week's show is going to be a sort of the real Music Relish show, because we're not going to discuss
the music. It's
going to
be the Music Relish show movie edition. Yeah.
Movie edition. Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, well, guys, okay, I have a trivia question.
So I hope you guys enjoy. I hope you enjoy the Sop with Camel story.
I did the Sop with Camel story. I didn't know that they were from. They were American. I didn't know they were. I assumed they were British, but they're actually American from the Bay Area.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
And I'm going to check out their second album for sure.
But they never. I'll check out the first. They could not last the other Bay Area, you know, because like a scene, like when Seattle happened, all the record companies wanted to sign these bands from Seattle.
Sure.
So San Francisco was a scene, and all the record companies came calling.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So a lot of bands got signed. A lot of bands might have had a hit or two, and some had longevity, some didn't. You know, it's a.
Yeah.
But I think, given the two records and given what I heard from this band, they could have done more, but, you know, things happen, you know.
Well, if I can carry on with the San Francisco thing, you know, I read a little bit recently about the Monterey Pop Festival in 67, which is when this band, were they at Monterey?
I don't recall reading that. I don't think so.
Maybe they were there and they didn't make the movie, or they made the, you know, I mean, but what I didn't know about the Monterey Pop Festival was it was Lou Adler and Derek Taylor put the thing together.
That's right.
And from what I understand,
John Phillips was he a music producer?
Lou Adler?
No, John Phillips. Did he do anything production-wise on that?
He may. I'm sure he helped Lou Adler out. But it was Derek Taylor and Lou Adler who were responsible for that. Was their thing to get it together. And apparently, a lot of the San Francisco bands did not want to sign on to play Monterey.
Yeah.
The San Francisco bands, because they did not trust Lou Adler, because he was from L.A. And, you know, San Francisco, they looked down upon L.A. Too slick.
Too slick.
To this, to that. Yep. And when you think about it, it's like, yeah, I kind of understand what they're talking about, you know? I get it.
It was more underground. It was definitely an underground scene. L.A. had, you know, the Wrecking Crew. The Wrecking Crew didn't play anything by the Airplane or Quicksilver.
Correct.
They would have loved to, I'm sure.
They were L.A. That was Frisco, yeah.
Yep.
And so, apparently... Yes. Go ahead. No, you go ahead, Lou.
So, like I said, it was a whole different scene. I mean, definitely, if you think about George Harrison visiting Haight-Ashbury. Right.
I know it now. Yeah.
Golden Gate Park.
Yeah. Yeah, he said, we spoke the other week about he had a bad experience in Frisco, but he kind of dug L.A. He rented a house in L.A. and all that, right? Yep.
Yep. Yep.
And apparently the back line for the Monterey Pop Festival, Fender lent the whole back line. Amplifiers and all the PA and the monitors and all that, all supplied by Fender.
Yep.
And they got them all back after the festival, except one. One amp disappeared.
Yeah. That's not bad. That's not bad.
That's not bad at all. Yeah. Yep.
By the way, Sop with Camel was not at Monterey. I just checked all the bands.
Yeah. Okay. I didn't see that.
But there was an issue at Monterey. So the San Francisco bands, they did not trust Lou Adler and Slick Los Angeles. They were not signing on. Jefferson Airplane, Grateful Dead, none of them were signing on to play Monterey.
Well,
so what they did was they got Paul Simon to intervene.
Huh.
And Paul Simon is the guy, the Paul Simon, who talked them into signing on, like it's going to be a big affair and it's going to be a lot of fun. And
wow.
So credit Paul Simon with talking all the San Francisco bands to sign on to play Monterey Pop Festival.
He acted as the diplomat.
He was the go-between, the diplomat, the savior. Yep.
Was he wearing a chicken suit?
No, he was not.
Hey, guys. You want to play the show? It's be cool. Come on, guys. It's going to be a lot of fun.
And when Big Brother and the Holding Company had played at Monterey Pop, they didn't even have a record deal. They just played.
That was like their big introduction to the business.
That
like
might have been their big introduction. Yeah. They just played. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
And the drummer that played with the Mamas and Papas was Fast Eddie Ho, H-O-H.
Yeah.
You talked about him one time. We mentioned him before. He got pretty incredible credentials, you know.
And
I think he's done the Super Session with Al Kooper and Steve Stills and Chris Hillman.
And on the film, some band like Moby Grape didn't make the film. Moby Grape is, I'll talk about them in the future. They are like one of the unluckiest bands in rock and roll history.
I tell you, I've never heard anything from them or Quicksilver Messenger Service. Those are two bands everyone talks about. Yeah. I've never really heard stuff.
Quicksilver, you've heard.
But if you
have
find
another
the film,
hit.
If you find the film at Monterey, there's like, you can see Moby Grape playing one song. And they were really good. They were really good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Skip Spence was playing guitar and singing.
The tragic Skip Spence.
Yeah.
Yep. Now, the guy in Quicksilver and Messenger Service, Dino Vanelli, do you know what big hit he wrote? We got some trivia.
I know Inside Myself. Gino
Vanelli. It's a classic anthem.
I know what he wrote. He wrote, I Like Dreaming, because dreaming can make you mine. Was that it?
F you. That was Kenny Nolan.
Okay.
No, Dino Vanelli wrote Get Together. No, come on, people now. Shine on your brother.
Yeah, Young
Come,
blood.
Come Together. But he wrote that.
See, I assume Jesse Colin Young wrote it, but he didn't, huh?
Maybe it was a co-writer. Maybe, I don't know, but I know I read where Dino Vanelli. Did he have a song? I'm thinking of Gino Vanelli. All
That's
I need
disco.
Is a... He did
Living
80s
Inside
big
Myself.
Well,
I like dreaming. Because dreaming can make you mine.
That was when they started going like Air Supply, and that side of stuff started coming around more and more and more. Yeah. Got really cheesy and really sappy.
Extreme
saccharine, right? Yeah.
Don't pick on Christopher
Well,
Cross.
Interesting. Mark, let me
Mr.
tell you
Yacht
something.
Rock.
Yeah.
Yeah. Here's my trivia question, Mr. Smith.
Okay.
Here's my trivia question. What artist/musician did Christopher Cross dedicate his song Ride Like the Wind to? He dedicated that song to a artist/musician. Ride like who did he dedicate that song to?
I just saw him on Rick Beato's YouTube show and he talked about it. Brain fart again. And it's not McDonald.
Lowell George.
It's Lowell George. Lou, how the fuck did you know that?
Lucky guess.
That song to Lowell George. Yep.
You know how I deduced it? Ride Like the Wind came out what year? 80 or 81?
79. And Lowell George died a few months before the song came out. Yeah. Yeah.
And anyone out there that
Such
thinks
a long way to go. Make it to the border of Mexico. I don't have a penalty box.
You can not on anyone, the show. You cannot do that.
If anyone out there thinks that Christopher Cross is just some lightweight, listen to him on Rick Beato. First of all, he was a key member of the Austin music scene, and he's a damn good guitar player on his own. Because in 2017, he put out an album. He does all the guitar playing on it, and it's good.
Yeah.
He's a good guitar player. He filled in, as he said, he filled in for Ritchie Blackmore on Deep Purple's first tour with the Mark II lineup. They played down in Texas. Ritchie Blackmore had a reaction to a flu shot, and he couldn't play, so they asked Christopher Cross, and Ritchie actually called him and said, you're the only one that ever replaced me, and he had him on a Deep Purple documentary. So he invited him to be there just to say, Ritchie was cool about it, you know? He didn't remember it, but Christopher Cross remembers it.
he was known when his first album came out. I was reading about him, like Rolling Stone, and it said he was known as a pretty hot guitar player.
Yeah.
And I'll mention when Perry comes back, but he filled in, America did some concerts, and he did a couple Dan Peake songs, like Don't Cross the River.
Oh, wow.
Things like, because he had a, Dan Peake, he sang the higher harmonies. He had the higher pitched voice of the two other guys. So for Jerry Beckley to sing some of his songs, it's kind of, he does it, but it's just, it's stretching it. It's hitting it. But he came in and sang like Don't Cross the River.
Oh, wow.
Lonely People and Beautiful. I mean, he's got a really, he's a great singer too.
Yeah.
But I said,
yeah,
like, you know, he would be a perfect, if America wanted to sound like America again, he'd be a perfect guy to do it.
Mm.
But he also, and as a hot guitar player, Dan Peake was a guitar. He was the guitarist and the guitarist guy in America. He played a lot of the leads,
okay,
electric stuff. So it was a perfect fit. But yeah,
yeah.
Like I said, people don't really know much beyond his hit songs, which are nice too. You know, Arthur's theme. You know, it's a Hollywood theme, but it's done very nice. He's got a very pleasant voice that sounds great on the radio.
Yeah.
Ultimate. And he's also got the ultimate yacht rock song. To me, it's Starbuck Moonlight Tonight. Moonlight Feels Right. But Sailing is the ultimate yacht rock song.
That's the ultimate.
He defined the genre.
Now, he introduced a guitar player to the world with that first album. On the last song, Fade Out, he has Eric Johnson playing the solo.
Oh, really?
And he's good friends with Eric because they're about the same age. You know, Eric's almost 70. And he got Eric signed to Reprise Records for his first couple albums.
That makes sense.
So, yeah.
Those Texans. So, Perry, I was mentioning that Christopher Cross did a couple shows with America where he did the Dan Peake parts on like Lonely People and Don't Cross the River, and he sounded amazing. Perry's got no mic.
He's the perfect guy
to
do the Dan Peake parts, if you ask me.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. It sounded amazing, but I guess, you know, he's too big to do that. But if they ever want to do like a mega tour, because they can still do it. I mean, they haven't hung it up yet. It was perfect. And, you know, a good singer. I mean, had a perfectly higher harmony voice guitar chops.
Right. I listen to Otis Gibbs every now and again. He's a musician, been all over the place. And he was saying recently that he will not go see the Eagles. The Eagles are doing their farewell tour.
Allegedly,
and it might be a year-long affair,
sure,
of course.
It's not longer.
He had said that he won't even go see the Eagles because they don't know who's in the Eagles anymore. I mean, it's not...
Yeah, you do.
It's not... what's his name's kid? It's not the Fry kid.
He's back doing the tour, so the final tour...
This is the final tour, so they're guaranteed lots and lots of money.
Yeah, and I suspect maybe Bernie Ledden might show up. Do you think Don Felder would get a chance to show
Otis
up?
Otis Gibbs' problem is that he said when they did the Hell Freezes Over way back 20 years ago, mm-hmm, whenever it was, when they first got back together, Otis Gibbs said that's when the ticket prices started going really, really high.
Wow.
And they were getting it a little out of... He said the Eagles kind of started that with the out-of-control ticket prices.
Really?
When Hell Freezes Over. Yeah, they kind of kicked it all in. Yep.
Now, what year was that? Was that the early 90s?
Hell Freezes Over? I'm not a big enough fan to even let you know. I think it was the 90s.
I'm trying to think. It was like 94 because they did the Long Road Out of Eden, but I think that might have been early 90s when they got... So that would make sense because it's that long ago that they got back together and just started touring endlessly.
Yeah, yep. But it's going to have to be the finale, so they say. But then again, you know, hey, Garth Brooks retired, right? And then but
Chris Gaines.
I miss filling stadiums, you know, and singing other people's songs. So.
Yeah. I'm used to people watching my shows in a stadium on screens. Mark, you might know this. The Eagles, Hell Freezes Over tour. Was that 94? Was that early 90s? Or did that follow Long Road Out of Eden? Am I getting my timeline mixed up?
No, see, the Hell Freezes Over was their initial getting back together.
Yeah.
And that was when Don Felder was in the band. He was part of that.
He was in the band. Okay. Yeah.
By the time they got to Long Road to Eden, that was the only solo album they've put out since The Long Run. And he wasn't on that. He was already kicked out of the band by then. Yeah.
That was like early 2000, like 2001, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
And, but yeah, the Hell Freezes Over came very early. In fact, they performed a few Don Henley songs in that too.
With your beard, you kind of look like Vince Gill somewhat.
Thank you very much.
They have to throw in the Don Henley originals. You know, Don Henley had some great, the solo careers. He had the best. best New songs, Don Henley.
He can't Minute. Sing them anymore. Can he sing them still?
Yeah, he sure can still he could. Sing. He's got a. He never really strained his voice. New York Minute is so good with the Eagles.
That's a good song. Yeah.
I got to say, I don't know if you guys mentioned it when I was off, but I am not into this farewell tour. It's a money grab. I'm sorry, but like you got
it's a final Eagles. It's a final payday. Absolutely. Yeah.
Who's opening? The Steely Dan. Now, I agree with Scott on Milk Crates and Turntables. Without Walter Becker, it's not Steely Dan.
Even with Fagan in it, it's not Steely Dan.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah. I wouldn't, and the ticket prices are going to be $250, $275.
Well, I was just saying to Lou while you were away that the Eagles kind of started that out of control ticket prices when Hell Freezes Over.
Yeah.
They kind of kicked it all in.
They were the first band I remember hearing charging $100 a ticket back in the late 90s, I think, or early 2000s. And I went, holy shit, $100 for a ticket?
I think that's what Otis Gibbs is talking about. Yeah. Way back then, $100. Yeah.
Yeah. And the Eagles also, along with The Who, started the farewell tour thing because they've done how many farewell tours? The Who, too.
Yeah. How about, can I talk a little bit about cutaways on guitars, guys?
Yeah.
I'll catch up with you.
Okay. Well, no, we're going to wait. We're going to wait for you, Lou.
Yeah. Want to talk about Behringer? Wine?
Behringer Chardonnay or Behringer Musical Equipment?
Oh, I have a bad memory. I actually, when I was in my early 20s, Perry, you probably remembered when we were neighbors. I went to a white Zinfandel phase. Oh, and I drank Behringer White Zinfandel. Oh. I don't know how I did it.
I just remember when we were neighbors, I remember you going out in the yard and vomiting over the fence all the time.
Oh, yeah, right. Yeah, just let the listeners believe that. I vomit in my bathroom, okay?
To anyone listening out there, I'm making it up. It's not true.
But I saw your neighbor with the sheets hanging. Oh!
I'm not commenting on that.
Yeah, me and Perry were neighbors. Never recorded a song together, did we, when we were neighbors? What shame.
No. Nope.
No.
We didn't record a song together till we went down to Barnardsville, North Carolina.
Actually, I played on a bunch of your songs before that.
In fact, it's our closing theme.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Boy, Lou is starting to be used for podcasts, right? He's got the Milk Crates and Turntables theme. He's got the end theme here.
Scott's got a lot of music on his, Scott McLean creates music, and he's working with us on, our project called Rage Against the Cafe.
To be heard soon. Yeah.
Well, soon. I know I'm about to send him something else. So it's up to you guys now.
Well, featuring that great session guitarist, Farknid Wondercrud. He is just fabulous. He puts that Mysterioso so guy to shame.
He's modest, yeah. Yep.
He's like the notorious Gundersnatch.
So... we're all guitar players. We all have guitars.
Yes.
I have two guitars, but Lou, you have about what, 8 or 10 of them?
I have about
guitars.
15 at this point.
They're hanging on your wall back there somewhere. Mark has more guitars than anyone.
He can't hang that wall fall down.
Mark's got a Gibson. Mark's got a Fender. He's got a G&L. Mark's got that old Japanese guitar you have hanging there, right?
The Martin, and I got the Martin, yeah.
But anyway, there's...
I have four guitars, two electrics, an acoustic, a bass, and a dulcimer.
Do you know the difference between the Florentine cutaways and Venetian cutaways on guitars?
No. Florentine has spinach in it, doesn't it?
No, it does not. It's got wine sauce.
Speaking of Yellowtail,
I'm going to give you a couple of pictures of Florentine guitars
here.
Here, you'll know the difference right away. Here's some Florentine guitars.
Apparently showing pictures for those that don't have cameras.
Florentine guitars have like pointy cutaways.
That's like the devil.
No, like the guitar player from The Rascals. He had a Florentine cutaway guitar with the pointy points.
Really? I think Bobby Weir played a guitar like that too.
The pointy points are Florentine cutaways. Like for instance, a Gibson SG is a Florentine. See the point? That's a Florentine cutaway when it's pointy.
Okay. Now the other guitar looked like devil horns.
They do. Yeah. Yep.
It does. Okay.
But pointy guitars.
Florentine, obviously influenced by something from Florence. Florence, Italy.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. There, a Gibson SG is technically a Florentine guitar because it's got two points.
Yeah.
So right? for those of you who are listening, when you go down the neck toward the body, where the body meets, where the neck meets the body, those point, it's not rounded. It's like there's like points that come up on either side, equidistant and the same size.
Right. So when you have a guitar with pointy cutaways, that's Florentine cutaway.
Just think of Tony Iommi from Black Sabbath.
Well, you think of those mandolins that you see, the F style mandolins that Marty Stewart played and all that. They're Florentine because they have that point. It's hard to see, but it's rounded, but then it has that point there. That's
right.
That's a Florentine cutaway. The other kind of cutaway are Venetian cutaways, and they're softer. I'll give you a couple of samples of a Venetian cutaway. Okay.
What's with the Italian influences?
You
tell us, Lou.
I don't know.
Do you see how they're not pointy? Rounded. They're rounded. They're soft. Mm-hmm. That's a Venetian cutaway.
Okay. Some people would call that sexy. I've heard people describe a Stratus.
I have another sample of a Venetian.
That's my guitar right there.
Do you see the soft curve? That's a Venetian cutaway. It's not pointy. It's rounded.
Now, for those of you that are not, that can see this, that is my Telecaster.
My Telecaster.
Not anymore. I bought it from you.
I want it back. I'm going to give you $300. I want it back.
Fuck that. I think it's worth $1,400, man.
But I sold you for three.
That's not the same thing. It's an investment.
You're trying to milk me for money? Come on. I've known you 40 years, man.
That's going to my son. Jesus.
Okay. I'm staying out of this.
So the Florentine cutaways on guitar are sharp and pointy. Venetians are soft and rounded.
Those Venetians are so rounded.
Yeah.
They're
more sensuously shaped.
Yeah.
Yeah. And of course, like Stratocasters are very space age. So, you know, and.
Yeah. Right? Very modern looking.
Yeah. But those are Venetian cutaways, are the soft ones.
Yeah. And I would say the Telecaster, it might be considered more of a masculine guitar looking, while the Stratocaster is more feminine looking.
Well, here's the thing about Telecasters that you and I both know. Telecasters bite.
Yeah.
Stratocasters are nice. They're smooth. They're cool. But Telecasters bite.
Yeah. It's snotty. Yeah.
I've heard more than one guitarist say Strats have a sexy look. Then that's it. Mm-hmm.
Sure they do. Yeah. What do you think attracts people to guitars, man? You know?
Yeah. Now, all three of us have Tele-like guitars now.
Yeah.
We all do. Yep.
Triple Teles. That's a lot of tinny. It's a lot of bite. Not very. They can sound very brittle, but they can also sound very, very warm. I think wasn't the first Led Zeppelin album recorded with an abundance of Telecasters?
The solo to Stairway to Heaven is on a Telecaster.
Yeah.
Also, there's a couple. There's a blues guitarist. He died. Robert. Oh, he was asked to join the Rolling Stones. I can't remember the guy's name. He wore like a hat. He played a Telecaster.
Michael Nesmith.
Robert something. I can't. And then there's a couple of jazz guitarists that are really good with Telecasters. Yeah, you can get a warm sound out of a Telecaster.
Hmm. I think Albert King played a Tele a lot.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah. Well,
Buddy Guy.
The guy that I was talking about.
Well, Buddy Guy's a Strat guy now, right? Polka dot Strat.
Yeah.
But I was talking the other week, Lou, when you were out of town, is that I was talking about the Blind Faith guitar. It was a Telecaster, and Clapton put a Stratocaster neck on it.
Okay.
Because he loved the feel of the Stratocaster neck, but the Telecaster bites, you know. Mm-hmm. The Telecaster barks at you.
Hmm.
And that's what then he became a mellow Strat guy after that. But, you know,
No, when even like normal pickups, you can soup up a Telecaster, you know, through our effect guitar effect simulators. You can really soup up a Telecaster to sound really distorted.
And but who makes those simulators, Lou? What company manufactures those simulators? They're called Behringer.
Speaking of that,
Mark had said before, a guy named Rob, and you had wanted to talk a little bit about the great Robbie Robertson. Did you not?
I thought we were going to do some trivia before we did talk about Robbie Robertson.
I did trivia before. I thought you were going to carry on some trivia. Well,
oh,
like,
no,
like, I you hit us we, with
we
some
jumped
trivia.
There you go. No, actually, I have some drum trivia.
Sorry, guys.
I lost my cue. You have the number two, Mark. I have the old one. Look
Perry,
at that.
Perry talked me into getting this. Best purchase I ever made.
Oh, look at the name under there. What is that name?
It says Behringer. Mark, do you have a favorite amp setting? Because I do. I have a couple of favorite amp combinations. Can you tell me yours?
I'm partial for clean to the tube preamp.
Say that again, please.
Tube preamp. Nice, and nice. I put on the chorus and compression on the effects. Okay. Mm-hmm. The Brit, I think it's the Brit high gain and the phaser. And I've gotten like almost a David Gilmour washy sound that I really
nice.
Like.
Nice.
All right, so it's a muddy, Marshall. But... It's a Marshall, right? The British high gain is a Marshall.
What are you partial to, Lou?
Okay, for my Telecaster, I do like the tweed combo. What I use is it's a number 5. It's a 2 12-inch. It's a Fender Blackface setting. So it's got 2 12s in it. Fender Blackface. The Telecaster just sounds beautiful through it. It can get clean and reverby. It can get bratty and distorted. It's a nice combination.
Oh, I'm gonna play with that. Thanks.
Yeah, I like that, and also the tweed combo with the 8-inch speaker.
Uh huh.
It's nice and compressed, and apparently that's what Jeff Beck did blow by blow with that type of setting. He's an 8-inch speaker. They just mic'd it.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. So, and I also like the there's a Marshall for clean sounds. I forgot what it was. It's something Clapton uses. It's like the Blues Breakers use it. I like that Gibson sound. For my Gretsch, I like Fender Bassman with 410s.
Listen to you.
Sounds really good. And I like the Vox AC30, the Beetle amp.
Love that. Love the Vox AC30. Yeah.
And I like delay.
Small one. Yeah.
Yeah. I like some delay on that, but I like the delay in chorus record. But I've been liking to play with a lot of delay lately. Just kind of, a slight delay just to thicken the sound out and do some atmosphere.
On my V-amp, I found a way to get the Elvis, Scotty Moore slapback, sort of thing on there. Yep. Yeah. That really sounds good with a Telecaster style guitar.
It does.
Shame.
It does.
Shame.
Those things are amazing. Perry, I was so reluctant to go digital. That's funny because you're the guy that you're very you're hearkening for analog days, but you were the first guy to go digital in my group, in my gang.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. So because I was like, I don't want to do that because I don't play through some box because
I was
recorded
ahead of the curve, man.
You were ahead of the curve. You were like the San Franciscans in South Park. You were sniffing your own farts out of big wine glass.
You're San Francisco. I was L.A.
You were slick, how are you?
Yep. Perry, you sold Lou. You sold me. You sold a lot of people on these direct boxes. You told me, point blank, just get one. And I will say, this is shameless to say, but it's true. The price you pay, you get a great... What was the one you had, Line 6? I couldn't afford it at the time. So I got the
I have both. I have a V-amp and a pod. Yeah. Line 6 pod. Yeah. And I will tell you too that these things I use the direct box through my piano, and you can really get creative when you plug it into your keyboard. Yeah. Yep.
What I did when Tom's song that first day that we recorded at a single wide sound studios, I took the keyboard, ran it through my Behringer guitar simulator and got a clavinet setting. And it just sounds, it's a weird sound, but it's just an odd combination of just trying something.
Yeah.
Now our friend Sot Mitter, our friend in Tennessee, he did
Sot
a lot
Mitter
of his
sing.
Stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sot Mitter sing. He used a little Line 6 pod. It's this big. It's the size of a small kidney.
You told me it's from like a baby's kidney or something.
If you surgically removed the baby's kidney and held it in your hands, that's what it would look like.
And it's red too, so
it is red. It's not dripping blood though.
But Lou, how about Robbie Robertson?
No, I got some trivia.
Oh yeah, trivia. Trivia, man.
Okay, this is drum trivia because I was reading because my original drum kit is my Slingerland 5-piece.
Can we get Fred Armisen on the phone? Maybe he knows the answer.
Well, I'm kind of curious about this kit now because I bought it in 1979, right out of high school. Yeah. And in 1982, Slingerland brought out all this new gear. It was called the Magnum 4 Series. The cymbal stands, you could hold a building on them. These things were, the posts were huge. Everything was big. The tom-toms were thick. Each tom-tom weighed 50 pounds. It was these giant machines, and it was for the metal years, I got to say.
Yeah.
Where the tom-toms were bigger for deeper projection. You couldn't be a normal player and get a good sound out of this thing. So Slingerland kind of went astray there. They actually went out of business. So they stopped manufacturing. I had the classic set.
Slingerland went out of business?
Yeah, I have a 12-inch, 13, 16 tom-tom, 22-inch bass drum. The classic sizes of drums that served us well throughout all eras of music. Anyway, so I got a question here. This is Slingerland. The Slingerland Drum Company... manufactured originally in what city? Was it A, Chicago, B, Niles, or C, Decatur, Illinois? All three cities were in Illinois. Was it Chicago, Illinois, Niles, Illinois, or Decatur, Illinois? Mark,
I think it was
first.
Niles, Illinois.
All right, well, Perry says Niles.
I'm going with Niles, too.
You were both correct. Oh, no, no, I'm sorry. Yeah. Wait, no, I'm sorry. It was originally in Chicago. Sorry.
Oh, the big city.
Now, the reason my mine were made in Niles. So the badges on my Slinger Kit says Niles, Illinois. But originally in Chicago.
Okay. That's Chicago. Why I said that, because I remember seeing the
probably
the badge.
On the badge. Yeah. Yep. Okay, so this might be an easy one. No one say anything yet. Ringo Starr played which brand of drums? A, Premier, B, Rogers, or C, Ludwig? Mark first.
Premier. Hey.
Mark says Premier. No.
Earwigs.
Perry's correct. He played the Ludwigs.
I'm lost on that kind of trivia.
And it's drum shit. Okay, so the upside down cymbal that is kind of math looks like the math upside down. The bell of the cymbal is adhered to the clamps. Upside down. Neil Peart plays many of them. I have one. Is it called an A, China cymbal, a B, sizzle cymbal, or a C, splash cymbal? Perry, you go first. China, sizzle, or splash?
Does he hit it from underneath?
No.
Does he hit it from underneath?
You could, not normal. You don't have to.
I'm going to say that's a China symbol.
Okay. Mark?
Splash.
Perry is correct. It is a China symbol.
Oh.
Well, so a China symbol is really just an inverted symbol.
Yeah, it's an inverted, but it has a ksh. I love a splash that symbol is very small. It's a very compact and a quick sound.
Okay.
The Premier drums. Premier drums are manufactured from what country? A, Germany. B, Great Britain, or C, the United States? Free for all.
Great Britain.
Perry says Great Britain. Mark?
Yep.
Germany.
Say Great Britain, Mark.
Germany.
Mark says Germany, but Mark is wrong because it is the Great Britain. Keith Moon was a big endorser of Premier Drums.
Nine.
As was Carl Palmer.
Yeah. Tip Scott, yes. Give a little. Okay. That's what Carl Palmer was, drumsticks. Give a little.
That was my choice.
Of course, I'm dyslexic, so it's called Plammer.
I know I am, but what are you?
We have some more trivia, though. July 7th, cool. Ringo Starr's birthday. Ringo turned 83 on July 7th. So that was 2 days
Ringo
ago.
Ringo Starr, 83 years old, the oldest Beatle, right?
By a couple months, yeah, the oldest Beatle. Ringo, 83. I heard a pretty cool NPR interview with him from like 2016 or whatever. And he was just talking about his life and how he got in the Beatles. He dares anybody to draw a comparison between his performance on the UK release of Love Me Do or Alan White, not of Yes, his version that was on the US release. You cannot tell the difference between the two. You cannot. And Ringo goes, I still dare anybody to find a difference. Meaning he should have played on it. And he said George Martin, in retrospect, was extremely apologetic. And Ringo's funny. He's a funny guy. He goes, you know, he never let him off the hook. You know, just basically said, yeah, it's okay, George.
So Ringo was the oldest Beatle. The next was Don Lemon.
Then Don Lemon, yeah.
Yeah, yep.
And then Paulie McCartney.
And then the baby.
Little George Harrison was the youngest.
Yeah.
Who's the real fifth Beatle? Is it Jim
Bernard
Keltner?
Purdy.
It's
George Martin. George Martin.
George Martin, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, he'd have to.
He played on so many songs.
He produced that shit.
Arranged the orchestration. Yeah. I mean, Eleanor Rigby is George Martin.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Also, that's him playing the harpsichord on Day in the Life. I mean, I'm in my life.
Oh, okay.
Which, by the way, is another thing you get with analog that you do not get with digital.
What's that?
Is, you know, George Martin turning the pitch down to half speed, playing the piano, turning it back up. With, you know, when you do an analog cassette, you have pitch control. You can, you know, make yourself sound like Davy Jones or what, you know what I mean? Like,
one big advantage to digital, though. I think it was, I'm trying to remember how certain albums in the 70s that they were going over and over so many times doing overdubs that they started to degrade the original master tape.
Well, okay.
That's an advantage of digital. You could sit there for 1,000 years going back and forth, you know. I think it was an Eagles album that they
Well, they probably
like
worked
that,
to death.
Yeah.
But at the same time, what's cool about analog is like, get it right the first time. Get it right as best as you can. When you have unlimited tracks, you don't, it's just the urgency to get it done and get it done right is just completely taken away. And you can cobble.
Well, we've spoken in the past about how they're all converted digitally now. So I'm sure when Steven Wilson remixes an XTC record, I don't think he has the two inch masters.
No.
I think he has a digital copy of the two inch masters. Right?
Yeah, he never sees the original master. He doesn't want to. He doesn't want to be stuck with that response. You know, like you could. So what he does is he has his specifications for how it's transferred. He tells him how to do it. He puts it on his Mac, and literally when he's on tour. He said when he was on one of his tours at night in the hotel room, you know, he's got nothing to do. He's not a drinker or a partier. He works on whatever the Jethro Tull album he's remastering because he literally goes, he goes beat by beat comparing the two. Like it's meticulous what he does. But yeah, that's where digital is good because once you digitize it, it's there forever.
And
all
the
multi
Iron Mountain has studios. They have built in studios there where they transfer these 2-inch master tapes to digital.
Yeah.
For preservation purposes, and also you can request them if you're going to do a remix or, you know, Steely Dan can request, you know, we want our tapes back. You know,
did they lose their
like
stuff in the fire, Steely Dan?
You know, we covered that with the UMG fire, but a lot
I think
of it was,
they did.
You know, it was in Pennsylvania. They had a lot of it in Pennsylvania. Some of the early Steely Dan recordings were saved because they were in a Pennsylvania underground.
But not Asia. That is heresy if Asia got burned. Oh, my God. You know?
Mark, I was at a party in Greenville last weekend, and I was talking to some other guys, a drummer, and Steven Wilson's and Porcupine Tree came up.
Really? Oh,
yeah,
wow.
At one place, I said, I have a good friend of mine is a big fan of Porcupine Tree and Steven.
Greenville,
Steven
North or South? Because there's
South
a Greenville,
Carolina.
North Carolina, too, right? Yeah.
And then I went to the bathroom, and I came back, and my girlfriend goes, everyone here says you look like the drummer in Rush.
I told you.
I'm like, I don't get it.
Well, you look like Neil Peart. When you were younger, you look like Neil Peart.
I don't get it. Anyway.
Well, look, who got me into Porcupine Tree? Sat Mitter.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah. He gave me that CD of Fear of a Blank Planet when me and Perry were down to see you. And that was it. I got on the bus. I was hooked forever.
We share.
I have one more trivia question.
Yeah, man.
This is... Let me get my cue card here. Cue him.
Cue King.
Cue him. Okay. Can you name for me REM, their first platinum album? Million selling. Their first platinum album.
Out of Time.
And I will give you a hint. It's on IRS Records, so it was one of their first five records.
It has to be Document.
Yeah, I
REM's first platinum album.
Document. I agree with
you. Document or Murmur?
Is that your... Well, that was their first album.
I'm saying like...
Document was like their fifth.
Platinum.
Yeah, platinum is a million selling. Gold is 500,000.
Oh, first million? Life Search.
This is their
Life
first
Search
platinum
pageant.
Album. Their first million selling album, yeah.
Life Search Pageant.
Mr. Smith?
I'm going to go with Document.
REM's first platinum album was, Lou, You Should Have Stayed Where You Were, is Document.
Was it really?
Oh. Yeah, yep.
I thought of the strength of Fall on Me that Life's Rich Pageant would have at least sold a million records. Okay.
Well, I have another REM trivia question if you want it, and this one's difficult.
Yeah, go for it.
You know why? Let me just say, you know why I answered that?
Why?
I was outside of REM's core. Like, you guys were hooked from the start. I didn't know much about them, but when Document came out, that's when I was like, I know REM now. That was a big album.
Yeah. I'm not surprised, but I did think they were on their way. It wasn't like the other albums, you know, sold moderately. They climbed all the way up until
had their
first top 10 single.
They gave you a new album every year.
Yeah.
5 years in a row.
Each year sold more, but the fact that Fall on Me, I heard on the radio everywhere. I figured, well, this is probably almost like a hit album.
Yeah.
Fall on Me was a record right before Document, I think, wasn't it?
All right, so now I know, Lou, you are a big enough REM fan. Mark, you're learning a bit, but REM had these, they had like two package records. One of them was called Eponymous, and another one was called Dead Letter Office.
Yes.
You're familiar, you guys are familiar with those records.
Both.
I've heard of them. I've heard of them, yeah.
Okay, so here's one more question. Which hard-to-find REM song was used in the soundtrack for the Tom Hanks comedy Bachelor Party.
Ooh.
It's one of these compilation records where, like, you know, two tracks, outtakes, and all these other things.
Wow.
So which hard to find, which hard to locate, excuse me, REM song was used in the soundtrack for the Tom Hanks comedy Bachelor Party.
That's such an old movie. God.
So that had to be like 1984, I think.
Okay. No, so we got a little clarification.
This it's an original not... REM song.
But it's not on a studio album.
It's on like Dead Letter Office or Eponymous. Or Eponymous. One of those things. Yeah. Yep.
Pale I'm just eyes. Amazed that...
No, it's an original song, Lou.
Oh, it's wrong. Oh, sorry. Yeah. White Tornado.
Guess. Good guess. I don't know. It's Wind Out when you're out on the street. Wind Out, Wind Out. Yeah, that was used apparently in the soundtrack for the...
TikTok, it's 10 o'clock.
For the Tom Hanks comedy Bachelor Party, which might have been his first movie.
Yeah, it was his first theatrical release. Do you guys remember hearing it in the movie? I don't. Yeah.
No.
I didn't like the movie. I thought the movie was a piece of shit.
I loved it.
who directed it? Was it Jonathan Demme or was it someone who actually would know?
One of those
REM's...
fluff guys, maybe. Yeah.
I see a fluff guy.
One of those fluffsters.
Jonathan Demme recorded. He did.
I know
Sounds
how great Jonathan Demme was. I know that.
Okay. Sounds of the Lambs isn't fluff. It's not their floofing.
Nah,
hey, Peter, it's not their floofing.
Bachelor Party was not
No, not the floofing.
Bachelor Party was
a
directed...
stupid movie.
Robert Zemeckis.
Nope, Neil Israel.
Ah, Neil Israel.
On television, he wrote Ringo, a special that starred Ringo Starr and George Harrison.
Really?
So. But not much. The Wonder Years, Nash Bridges, Joan of Arcadia. Yeah. Yeah, he's a TV guy.
TV guy, yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
I recently saw a thing about Sid Vicious. No, Sid Barrett.
Big difference.
And big difference. Yeah, really. One could play.
They're both English.
Well, they're both out of their minds, though. Unfortunately,
True.
You True. Know.
Yeah.
It was a Sid. It was a Pink Floyd thing. Sid Barrett. It was the Sid Barrett era.
Yeah, right.
And kind of sad, you know, and, you know, they said, well, he was so shy, but they said he was hanging out like at this commune, like living with 15 people. And all they did was drop acid all day, you know, and it's going to come back
that
and bite
the same person crazy.
Right. Yeah. Yep.
Too bad.
When I just
I did a tab before we went on the show here tonight.
You did a what?
You look fabulous.
Oh,
you look really good. You're wonderful. Well, you're wonderful tonight.
There, I see lights flashing, Lou, like, wow, your hand is going back a little while.
Oh. Mark has a clock in his forehead, and his glasses have the spiral circling things in it. Perry, I can't see you. Perry is devil. Perry has a red
Charlie
tail
Manson.
With a point.
I'm Charlie Manson.
Charlie M.
When I saw Roger Waters last year.
Dump. Garbage.
When I saw Roger Waters, this is for Lou, by the way. When I saw Roger Waters last year, he had on the screen said talk, and he had like writing on the screen. It's about being in L.A. with Sid Barrett in the car, and they were driving on Wilshire Boulevard.
Yeah.
And the first thing Sid said was, "Isn't Phoenix great?" Like he didn't even know what city they were in.
They
and
were then, in L.A. Wow. He didn't even know where he was. Yeah.
And then like he looked around, and all he said was like there were people walking around. He just went people, and that's all he said. Like, it's sad. Like the stuff that Roger put on the screen about Roger, you know, one thing at Gilmore and Waters, they loved him. Both of them. They loved him. Yeah. They loved
Absolutely.
The guy.
I mean, why would you be writing songs about him? Like Shine on Your Crazy Diamond.
Yeah.
And love that story about when they were doing Wish You Were Here.
Yeah.
I don't know where they were, you know, what studio they were in, but like Sid turns
Abbey Road.
Up.
They did that
turns
in Abbey Road.
Up and he's like, his eyebrows are shaved. His head is shaved. His everything is shaved. Like, they didn't even know it was him.
Did you ever see the picture of him when he showed up?
Oh, sure. I've seen a picture of me.
It's kind
of
creepy.
Disturbed looking.
Yeah. If I saw him walking down the street, I'd go
to the other
side. Yeah.
They were recording? I thought it was Shining. Oh, it wasn't Shining You Crazy Diamond.
Oh. You know what? Lou may have a point. I just
Shine On You Crazy Diamond is a song that Roger wrote about Sid. Yeah.
But that wasn't the song they were playing when he showed up at the studio, or was it?
It might have been that coincidental that it was. Yeah.
Yeah. But kinda, at the same time, like, weird, at the end of his life, you know, I don't know when he died, but, you know, he seemed to have some kind of way of living. Looks like he was taken care of. I mean, for what it's worth at that point, you know, life is life. You know, he seemed to, he seemed to have some kind of adult life somehow, you know, in spite of all the damage.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, anyway,
was,
you guys want to
Wish You Were Here, by the way. They were recording Wish You Were Here when you went in.
Wish You Were Here, yeah. That's the Man on Fire album, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, I also incidentally,
they were wasting Abbey Road studio time, had nothing. They were, like, just sitting there, they had nothing. Just like with Dark Side of the Moon, nothing. They were almost like another disaster.
So they were writing songs in the studio.
They just, something clicked, and then they wrote these songs, you know?
Even the Beatles didn't do that. They had songs written before they went in there.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Isn't that kind of what you're supposed to have when you go to a recording studio?
Especially Abbey Road.
Right?
Yeah.
So how, do you guys want to shut the show down, and maybe we'll just roll some closing credits?
Have a little quick thing on Robbie Robertson.
Oh, yeah, we never got to Robbie, man.
We never got to Robbie.
Yeah, let's get to Robbie. Yeah. Let's get to Bobby.
Save you, Lou.
Bobby Robertson. Now, let's get to Bobby him. Robertson. What about him?
It's another birthday week because his birthday was July 5th. So it's it was his 80th birthday. He was born July 5th, 1943. In brief, you know, if you know the band's history, if you know some stuff, if you've seen VH1 specials, Robbie Robertson, there he was. He was the songwriter and guitarist for the classic band the band,
you know,
people, yeah, right, exactly, people know them by the songs. Oh boy, I got some songs written down here somewhere.
Somewhere,
The Weight,
Over the Rainbow,
somebody throw me a book, The Weight, The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down, Great Up on time. Cripple Creek, Ophelia, Chess Fever, and he's done other things too. Joan Baez had a first hit with The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down, which is a horrible version.
May I interject something, Lou?
You may
interject.
Yes, sir.
I cannot stand to listen to Joan Baez sing anything.
Okay.
The timbre of her voice drives me friggin' batty, man. I can't stand it. So I don't even want to hear her version of The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down.
I take you to task for that. I like Joan. Her version of Diamonds and Rust, Judas Priest couldn't even match it.
Crap. Crap.
Up on the screen, Perry's got Robbie Robertson from the concert movie The Last Waltz with the late great Ronnie Hawkins doing Who Do You Love? It's one of the highlights.
Garth, don't you give me no lip.
Yeah, one of the highlights of the movie. So anyway, so with Robbie Robertson, you know, so the band was his classic rock band. They helped define the term Americana before it was what it was.
Yeah.
Not like a lot of the bands, you know, they might have spurred that going back to the country movement. There's Robbie at the Academy of Music, New Year's Eve, 1972, I think, when he played amazing
Telecaster with a humbucker. Yeah,
that's from the Rock of Ages album. It's a great live album. Robbie played amazingly, so we can talk about him as a guitar player. But anyway, some short stuff. He was in the band. He's in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, the Canadian Music Hall of Fame, Canada's Walk of Fame. There you go. In Rolling Stone's 100 Greatest Guitar Players, he's ranked number 59, so not too bad. He's in the Canadian Songwriters Hall of Fame, Lifetime Achievement from the National Academy of Songwriters. Notable songs, The Weight, like I said, The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down, Up on Cripple Creek, Ophelia, Chess Fever. Of all these songs that I mentioned, all of them were sung by Levon Helm, where although the band themselves considered Richard Manuel their lead singer, to me, it's Levon. That period, you know, the second album was something where his voice suited all those songs, and it got them noticed. I'll say that. On his solo, and he had two singles, Somewhere Down the Crazy River, Broken Arrow.
Yep.
The albums that he's been on is the music with the band, Music from Big Pink, the second record of the band itself, otherwise known as the Brown Album, Classic Rock. That's on my top five all-time records. The third album, Stage Fright. The fourth album, Cahoots. Rock of Ages, the live album, a great live album. If you want to hear some great guitar playing, Robbie played amazingly. He was on fire. Their album of covers, Moondog Matinee, one of the best rock and roll classic covers album ever. Their other album, Northern Lights, Southern Cross, the last proper studio album in 1975. They had an album called Islands. That was like a contractual thing after The Last Waltz. Had some outtakes, things like that. And the concert album from The Last Waltz itself. Albums with Bob Dylan he did. Planet Waves in 1974. That's the album Dylan did with the band before they went on tour.
Yeah.
There's the Before the Flood live live album. That was one of the first big mega tours too. So in 74, Dylan and the band did a tour behind that. That was one of the first big mega tours. I think it's a Bill Graham production, all that stuff. But yeah, big money. People were complaining about rock and roll became kind of bourgeois at that point because pot became cocaine. Things became expensive. Concert tickets went up in price. You know, it was starting to climb even back then. So the whole that was one of the first big rock event concerts outside of like a Beatle tour.
Yeah.
So his solo records, Robbie Robertson in 1987. It's a good record. Daniel Lanois produced it. It's a modern record with U2 and Manu Katché.
I really like it.
There's some great songs on it.
The song with the Bodines, up somewhere up that crazy river.
That was the lead off single from that record, actually.
Yep.
And Golden Arrow. Second, yeah, yep. The Broken Hours made into a hit by Rod Stewart.
Yeah.
His second record was Storyville. I listened to it today. It's a good record. You know, excellent. Robbie's not a singer, but he sings like a lot of singer-songwriters do. He can do his own material.
Yeah.
Storyville is really good.
Right. Yeah. His third solo record, Contact from the Underworld of Red Boy, kind of a Native American-inspired thing. How to Become Clairvoyant in 2011 and Cinematic in 2019. He also, after his rock career kind of went, he kind of hung it up and retired in a sense after The Last Waltz. Him and Martin Scorsese had a long-running partnership on movies. So he did film work for The Last Waltz. The movie called Carney came out in 1980. He starred in it
I enjoyed that oddball little movie, yeah.
It's an oddball little movie. It's a Robbie Robertson. Gary Busey as a clown, which is great. And Jodie Foster is kind of an awkward thing because she's very young. It's post-Taxi Driver. But Robbie Robertson's the manager of a traveling carnival show, and it's the things that ensue. But it's worth it just to see Gary Busey as a clown in the dunk tank.
Crown on a friggin' riding a motorcycle without a helmet. Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Huh. So after that, with Martin Scorsese, he did the music for Raging Bull, one of my favorite movies, The King of Comedy with Robert De Niro, The Color of Money. Jimmy Hollywood, I never heard of. He was a musical consultant on Casino. He was in a movie called The Crossing Guard in 95 with Jack Nicholson. He plays a character called Roger in it.
Jimmy Hollywood was actually a pretty cool little movie.
Was it?
Yeah.
The Crossing Guard was a great movie.
I never saw it. He was a composer for that.
Yeah.
So The Crossing Guard was directed by Sean Penn. Jack Nicholson was the star of it, so Robbie plays a part in that. He did the music for Phenomenon. Actually, in the movie The Crossing Guard, Jack Nitschke, the famous songwriter-producer, that was the last movie he scored before he died.
He did the movie for that. He did the music for that John Travolta movie, Phenomenon?
No, he did it for The Crossing Guard.
Oh, I thought you said Phenomenon.
No, I went back to it. So Robbie did the music for Phenomenon, but he also acted in The Crossing Guard with Jack Nicholson. But that movie, The Crossing Guard, Jack Nitschke, the famous producer that wrote, what was the big song he wrote with Sonny Bono? Needles and Pins.
Needles and Pins.
Amongst other things. Yeah. That was the last movie Jack Nitschke steward before he died. And then God could truly say Nitschke is dead. So Robbie also did music for Gangs of New York, Any Given Sunday, The Wolf of Wall Street, and The Irishman. So besides the band, he's had a big Hollywood career. He's always come under fire for songwriting, sharing, whether he should have shared things enough.
Robbie on this one. He wrote the fucking songs.
I always did. You know? I was always self-conscious because everyone bashes on him saying he should have shared more. But maybe nowadays he would. Back then it was a different thing. But when you really read all those stories about the band, every book that anyone ever wrote about him as much as you can, the clearer picture is that, you know, I think he did a lot of things that he kept that band going. You know, he suffered for his qualities of organization and leadership.
It got to the point where, like, well, I played bass on it, therefore I'm a co-writer. You know, like, nah, man, that ain't happening. Yeah. You know, your job is to play bass on the goddamn song.
And everybody in the band made millions of dollars.
Right.
Yeah.
It's what you did with it. He's the guy. Lou, you and I have had this conversation years.
Yeah.
He's the guy in L.A. driving around in a Mercedes, and the rest of them are struggling to pay their mortgage. Yeah. In New York. Yeah.
And the bass player, when he went into my dad's bank, they were told when he cashes a check for $1,000, do not give him 20s. There's a reason for that. Poor guy.
Yeah.
LeVon, just a friendly guy, but broke because if he got $100, he would give it to somebody if they needed it. Poor guy, you know. And he
that
got used.
John's song, is that about LeVon Helm?
It's not about him, but the fact that their second record was such an influence on so many people that Elton John or maybe Bernie Taupin actually just like the name, Levon's name. It's a cool name, Levon. Yeah.
That's a cool name. Well,
he changed
really
Levon, L-A-V-O-N. He changed it to L-E.
Hey, Levon was cool, man. The American. Yeah.
Yeah.
Southern. He's cool. The Arkansas boy, right?
Yeah. Well, yeah. While Robbie wanted to be the actor, Levon was the actor of that band.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Coal Miner's Daughter, Levon Helm.
What's the movie with Steven Seagal? Fire Down Below. He was
Fire
great
Down
in that.
Below. Fire
he
Down
was,
Below.
Yeah. He was the preacher in the church. Yeah. He was the church preacher, yeah.
And in The Electric Mist?
Yeah.
Now, with Coal Miner's Daughter, they said there was rumor of maybe a Best Supporting Actor Oscar bid. That would have been so cool.
The Right Stuff.
Hmm.
The Right Stuff, yeah, Jack Ridley.
And, of course, End of the Line with Wilford Brimley.
With Alfred Wimbley. It's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
But did he have the diabetes?
Wilford Brimley was amazing. He lived out in Utah, and he finally died. But I remember seeing The Natural with Robert Redford, right? So Robert Redford was maybe 40 when he made the movie. He was supposed to play like an aging ball player. And Wilford Brimley was like the old grizzled manager. Robert Redford was 40. Wilford Brimley was 42. He just always looked so old.
He really
looked old. When he was in his 40s, he looked like he was 70.
60s. You know? 70. Also, in John Carpenter's The Thing, he played Blair.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
I love that movie. The original.
He didn't have that classic signature mustache, so you might not know it's him.
But why did they remake it? They always do that because of the special effects, because of the AI,
because they don't have to develop a movie. The remake sucks.
The original one with Kurt Russell is good.
The original has James Arness from the 50s. So the John Carpenter one is the first remake, but that's a case where they really did it well.
That's a black and white.
The first one has James Arness of Gunsmoke.
Now,
James Arness's brother was who? The actor James Arness.
Forrest Tucker.
Nope. Peter Graves.
Wow.
Peter Graves, the guy from Mission Impossible?
Yeah, Peter Graves and James Arness are brothers. Or were.
Really?
Relish trivia. Okay.
Circling back to Wilford Brimley, he did a movie with Tom Cruise where he was part of a law firm, and he scared me in that movie. Because every time Wilford showed up in a boardroom with his glasses, somebody got killed.
Wasn't it? Wasn't it called the firm?
Yeah.
He was the firm.
Yeah. He was the man.
He was the security guy. He was the head of security.
Yeah, yeah.
That's right. Yeah. I saw that movie in Florida. With my first wife,
the great Wilford Brimley, also a member of the Latter Day Saints.
Wilford Brimley,
yeah.
Wow.
Okay. Now, before we end, I just want to backtrack one thing. There's one recording from the band. It's post everything, but in 2013, the concerts that made Rock of Ages, they released as a 4-hour multi-disc set. It's all the recordings from the Academy of Music, all the recordings like the concerts that made up that album.
Yes.
It's key to listen to because you're hearing the full concerts. And it's
I believe Robbie's son, Sebastian Robertson, was a musical. I think he supervised the remixes, I think, on that.
Then that's why it's so good. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I have some Robbie trivia before we sign off.
All right.
Okay. Now, during the band's run, he was not known as a lead vocalist, correct?
Right.
Correct.
However, he sang 3 lead vocals on the whole band's catalog.
I couldn't tell you any of them.
Okay, so
you've Shape heard music I'm In?
Nope, he wrote it. So from music...
No, that was Ricky Manuel. Yeah.
That was Ricky Manuel.
Yeah.
So with The Placements, Ricky Manuel. So on the first record, music from Big Pink, he sang the second song called To Kingdom Come.
Never heard it.
If you've heard the album, you've heard the song. It's an album track, but it's a really great song. The drumming is really cool.
I always say, don't like it, next into the hit, you know.
Right. So on his other lead vocal was a song, I think it's on maybe Northern Lights, Southern Cross, or Cahoots, called Knockin' Lost John. And a song called Out of the Blue that's on, I think it's on the record Islands. Islands was a compilation of things they had to do to get out of their contract after the last waltz.
Kind of a softer album.
Well,
right.
Yeah. It's got almost like some reggae-ish songs. Mm-hmm. The song Out of the Blue, it's a blues, actually. It's a very tender blues. And I think the vocal is quite good. He's not Levon Helm or any of the other two guys. He does carry it across really well.
Yeah.
Because there's not, he sings with emotion. What's that?
But he's not the guitar player from the Eagles, you know, who demanded to sing 3 songs on an album or something.
No, he wasn't Don Felder who just shot himself in the foot.
But I loved, I had, in fact, His first solo album, Somewhere Down the Lazy River. Yeah.
You know what makes
crazy
that album?
River. Somewhere Down the Crazy River.
You know what makes that album important to me, Perry? That's when CDs were first launched and I got my first CD player. That was one of
it
my
was
first
in the
CDs.
80s, yeah.
Yeah. And a lot, like when he first came out, I was like, ooh, his vocals are rough, but they grew on me real quick. Yeah. I love the way he sings, you know?
Take a picture of this.
And I also read his book, Robbie Robertson's book, Testimony.
Testimony.
I enjoyed it. I absolutely enjoyed the book. Yeah. I thought it was great. Yeah.
I'm about 100 pages into it. I've been reading it. Because you sent it down to me, so I kind of peeked in a bit, but I'm getting into it. You know, and the way he talks about the other members of the band.
He loved Levon. He loves them all.
There's no way he's ever going to get away with the shit that's been, you know, thrown at him. So maybe he's an arrogant dick.
I think that's long forgotten, I think.
Every time I mention him to certain people, they're like, if he wasn't such a blah, 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 blah. But yeah. I don't want to get into that. But if
Stay off the threads. Don't even bother with the threads, you know.
No, it's people I know, but not us. But the thing was, the last documentary he did, Once We're Brothers, the way he talked about Levon, he goes, he glowed in the dark. I said, well, you know, come on, man. He was just. Yeah.
He saw him on his deathbed like Paul saw George on his deathbed.
And Paul said he held his hand for hours, and that's what they did. You know, those private moments, we don't need to know. But, you know, I would even say, like, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if Robbie helped the other guys along the way. He doesn't have to talk about it. And if he did, it would just be him trying to get some attention or just saying, you know, I'm not such a dick or whatever. But nobody knows what goes on. And if you're true to yourself, you don't have to talk about it, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But as a guitar player, I think he's great. Described as an enthusiastic amateur. Robbie was never slick. You know, if you look
learned
at the last waltz.
Learned a lot from Curtis Mayfield. Learned a lot from people that he admired like that. Yep.
Roy Buchanan.
That's who I was trying to think of, the telly player, Roy Buchanan. Thank you, Roy Buchanan. The guy played
bending multiple strings at once to make it sound like, you know, like a pedal steel and
absolutely.
Use of volume control.
Hey Lou, I still remember when I found out you were a Levon Helm worshiper, and my dad just, you know, when he started working at the bank in Woodstock, and he's called me one night and he goes, "Did you ever hear of a guy named Levon Helm?" I go, "Yeah." He's the nicest guy. He's so nice. He comes in and he talks to me. I actually got in trouble because I talked to him for too long. They told me I had to. I think all the guys in the band were kind of like that. You know,
they're
just good guys.
They're all very personal. Maybe Robbie wasn't. Maybe he was, you know, snobby Robbie, they called him. But
I don't think snobby, just very reserved and artistic.
I don't think
so.
I remember reading that story in his book.
It's just stories.
About when they were playing in the, they were playing in San Francisco, I don't know, Winter Garden, like. He had the flu. He had to have like a psychiatrist or a hypnotizer.
A hypnotist
come down and like get him onto the stage, and he did. Right.
Yeah. Mm. The first show, they think it was maybe psychosomatic. He had a terrible case of stage fright. He was so insecure that, you know, the music the band made on their first record, Music in Big Pink, and even the second record of the band was very different than what they did. I don't think they expected to become that. It was his guitar playing changed because that guy could wail for hours. So the Dylan tours were all solos and force and rock and shoving his stuff down people's throats reluctantly, but when they moved to Woodstock, they mellowed out. They found this kind of country soul sound.
Yeah.
So he was afraid, you know, they was just not going to go over. And also, when they appeared at Woodstock, he goes, "We're like a bunch of preacher boys in an army of mud people." He said ripped mud people. Everyone was all fucked up. Rick Danko and John Sebastian were the guys cooling people down in the tents when they were all flipping out on the brown acid. That was Rick Danko did a lot of calming down. And also with John.
Really,
Sebastian,
he was with the people. Oh,
well,
wow.
I'm sure
he was there.
I'm sure with Robbie. I mean, you know, he was 16 years old when he was on the road.
Shit, yeah.
With the Hawks, right?
Well, you know, that's part of the whole, you know, his thing. You know, we didn't touch upon his background. You know, he's half Native American. His mother was Native American. His father was Jewish. He found out as a teen that the man that raised him was not his biological father. So his father's real name was like some Douglas or something Klagerman. Mm-hmm. So once he found that out, because he didn't know his parents, the biological father, he thought he had divorced his mother. So his mother took him to the Indian reservations where, you know, that's how he became a storyteller. You can hear it in his writing, obviously.
Yeah.
And he does lots of charity work up in Canada for Native North Americans. He absolutely does. Yep.
And Artists Against Racism.
Yeah.
Being a Native, a Jewish Amerindian, they call him, you know. Yeah.
I like that.
A very wise guy. You know, he was the youngest one guy in the band, too.
Yeah.
But he was no dummy. Ronnie Hawkins, you know, the Hawk, one of my favorites. He recognized the talent in him young and even said, he told people when he took Robbie to the Brill Building when they went up to New York as a kid.
Yeah.
And one of the Hawks, Ronnie Hawkins' first records has two Robbie compositions. Yeah, so he was a teenager. So of all the Hawks, he's the guy that got a couple songs on a Ronnie Hawkins record.
Yep.
So Ronnie took him to Tim Pennell and said, the kid's going to be a star one day. So Ronnie Hawkins was a smart guy. He knew the talent he had. So he was he became a very big fish in a smaller pond up in Canada. You know, no dummy.
Yeah, the great Robbie Robertson, 80 years old.
80 years old, yeah. Yep. Happy birthday, Robbie.
Happy birthday, Robbie.
Thank you for Robbie Robertson. I'd like to say that the Music Relish Show is available on Spotify, on Apple Podcasts, on Google Podcasts, on Amazon Music, on Overcast, on Pocket Casts, on Podcast Addict, on Facebook, perhaps?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. YouTube?
Yes.
Yep.
Podchaser.
Podchaser, yeah.
And again, on Facebook, if we talk about a song we can't play, I will post the whole song on the Facebook page. So find us. And please, if you like it, even if you listen to us on YouTube, subscribe on Facebook too. Yeah. Click like. We appreciate it.
And I'd also like to say that say thank you to new subscribers, Mary and Simon.
Woo!
Yeah.
Welcome to the Music Relish Show family.
New subs. Yeah. Yep.
Welcome.
Yep. And I think we're ready to kick this pig, don't you think?
Put this limping dog to rest.
I just want to say one thing. Thank you guys for letting me be the new guy on the show. I really appreciate it. Part of your 50-year history.
You're fired.
Come on, man.
You can't put me in the green room, Perry.
What is your major malfunction, numbnuts?
And I want to say thank you to Behringer. I want to say thank you, Behringer, for giving me this great, great. I mean, I bought it. But...
You bought that.
Well, you know what?
Endorsements are nice, I hear. I hear endorsements are a good thing for like a growing musician. Yeah.
This Yellowtail is going down really good. You know?
You know, Lou, we're talking instruments. He's talking wine. I mean, what does that tell you, you know?
I'm a snob.
He gets nothing.
I'm just a snob from Pearl River. Not Pearl River, New York.
So, yes, it was a good show. We were at 2 hours and change over 20 minutes, man. Went fast, didn't it?
Did. Had to go to the bathroom. I knew it was a
Tony Orlando always says, great to be back. Great to be back.
It's good. Yeah, I was in jail for a weekend.
You were in jail. That's what I always tell people.
Jail for 2 weeks.
Don't worry, I was in jail. I was locked up.
I might rob a liquor store in a couple weeks.
I killed a guy.
Don't bust up my party.
Fucking break up my party.
Wait, I have to extend my pinky here.
Oh, so next week we're going to do the Music Relish Show mob movies, right?
Mob movies.
Yeah.
We're going to have bars across our faces so you can't see us.
We're going to have an anonymous intro, because we don't want to use our real name, right?
Frank Doe.
I would also like to thank WD-40 for making my chair less squeaky tonight.
WD-40?
You're a whore.
You know what WD stands for?
Water displacement.
Water disbursement, water displacement. Yep.
I would like to thank ShopRite paper towels.
And they tried 39 times. The 40th time, they got the mixture right. That's why it's called WD-40. Yeah.
Do 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 do.
That's the towel rock, Lou.
Yeah, man.
Do 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 do.
Do 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 do.
And of course, we always acknowledge our friends Scott McLean, Jack Calabrese, Milk Crate, and Turntables, usually on Wednesday evening sometime, correct?
We would like Jack to be on the show more often, because when he's on, it's freaking awesome.
Although Mark and Lou need a vacation day.
And do not forget, Rage Against the Cafe whenever you can. Yeah.
Jerry says.
Always.
Bye-bye.
See ya.